फैसला किया जाए, मालूम लगा उसको।
দেবু সবাই মিউট করা আছে?
হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ, আমি এভাবে চেক করে নিচ্ছি। ওকে, এ ভেরি গুড মর্নিং টু এভরি ওয়ান অন দিস বিউটিফুল মর্নিং। উই প্লেস টু ওয়েলকাম আওয়ার রিসোর্স পার্সন পার্টিসিপেন্ট টু অন ডে ন্যাশনাল ওয়েবিনার অন অ্যাপ্লিকেশন অফ রিমোট সেন্সিং জিআইএস অন ফিজিওগ্রাফিক্যাল স্টাডিজ। Now we express our felt thanks to all the participants of India and across the world. Now we extend our warm welcome to our principal, Dr. Pradeep Kumar Banerjee. Now I request Rupkatha to inaugurate the program with her beautiful song.
At first, I am wishing so many respect and rigors to the principal and all. I am Rupkatha from Kolkata. I am studying in class 6. Today, I am going to perform a song which is based on Mahamanav Ishwarchandra Vidyasagar on the occasion of his 200th birth anniversary. The lyrics is written by Kavi Achintya Suran and music composed by my mother, Shri Padmasundari.
হাতে ধরে তোর মনে মনে আমি চাই
Thank you, Rupkatha. Thank you, Rupkatha, for this beautiful song and making this morning more charming. Now I request our convener, Professor N.N. Yadav, HOD, Department of Geography, Jamini Roy College, request to deliver her inaugural speech.
Thank you, Devabroto. Good morning, everybody. I extend a very warm welcome to all of you of this one-day national webinar on application of remote sensing and GIS on physiological studies organized by Department of Geography and IQAC, Jamini Roy College. I hope that today all of you will have the most productive day of interesting and stimulating discussion with our efficient speakers. I sincerely wish that this webinar will have a great success, not only as an opportunity to share knowledge and experiences in higher education, but also as the beginning of long and fruitful cooperation and friendship among the participants. I am very grateful to the Honorable Principal Sir Dr. Pradeep Kumar Banerjee for helping me in every way by allowing and cooperating with such a wonderful webinar. I have never seen him tired. I have never seen him burnt out. He is always hardworking and enthusiastic. He is the driving force of our college. To welcome is to show honor. To welcome is to establish the integrity. I invite Honorable Principal Sir Dr. Pradeep Kumar Banerjee to deliver the welcome address. Due to some technical error, our Principal Sir addressing the welcome through telephone.
Thank you. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Good morning to everybody. On behalf of Jamini Roy College, I welcome our Chief Patron and Honorable President of Governing Body of our College, Sri Ashutosh Mukherjee Sir, my very respected resource person, dignitaries, faculty members of different colleges, my colleagues, and students for participating to this one-day national webinar on application of remote sensing and GIS on physiographical studies. This webinar has been organized jointly by the Department of Geography of our college and IQAC of Jamini Roy College. I am really grateful to our honorable resource person, Dr. Avira Dr. Rai, from Department of Geography of Bankura Jila Sarada Muni Mahila Mahavidyalay for joining with us and to speak on cryosphere studies in India and Himalaya. Thank you, madam, for sharing your very valuable time with us. I heartily welcome to Dr. Pratik Das from Adamas University for accepting our invitation and to speak on this digital platform. Dr. Pratik Das will speak on application of remote sensing and GIS on disaster management. The topic is highly interesting and nowadays it is well applicable to each and every step of our life. Thank you, sir, for your kindness to join with us in this webinar and to share your knowledge to our participants. Now, I want to say about our college in very few words. Our college was established in December 1986 and named after the world's greatest artist, Jamini Roy, who pioneered the modern art culture not only in India but also in the globe. The goal of our college is not only to cultivate the quality education among the students, but also we organize various social work for the poor people of our society. Even during this pandemic, these work has been nicely done by the very active and sincere NSS unit of our college. I also very glad to inform you that we not only organize digital platform for such webinar or seminar, but we also teaching classes digital for the students from the home. And for this digital classes, we are following and a very advanced software, the learning management system, to continue the academic activities of our students. And it has only been possible due to dedication of our faculty members and my office staff. I am not the teacher of this remote sensing or like that, but in few words, so far my knowledge is concerned about remote sensing, I want to say that the remote sensing is a process to detect the physical characteristics of an area, and this work is done by the philosophy of reflection and emission of radiation, and it is done from a distance with some special cameras from satellite or aircraft. These cameras take image of large area on the earth surface and help us to see much more bigger inside than we see on the ground. It helps in mapping of topography, large forest fire, clouds, predict the weather condition, volcanic eruption, and also changes in the farmland or forest. In this context, we have organized this platform to meet together so that we get more valuable and resourceful information about remote sensing and GIS from our very resourceful and respected speaker, because we are master on this topic. I convey my thanks to Professor Lakshmi Narayan Jadhav, HOD and convener of Department of Geography, Professor Devaprakash Bhattacharya, Board Chair ITC of our college, joint convener, other members of webinar committee, and others who extend their help to organize this webinar. Generally,
thank you, sir.
One minute.
Okay, sir.
You know that these webinars have been organized on a digital platform, and the performance of this webinar depends upon so many technical parameters. If any technical or other problems occur during this webinar, I beg to be excused. Pray to God for your safe and healthy life. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Now I request Ellen Yadav sir introduce our first speaker. Please introduce our first speaker.
Okay, without any delay, we start our main technical session. Our first speaker is Dr. Avira Dattorai. I would like to introduce Dr. Avira Dattorai. Avira Dattorai is an assistant professor of geography at Bankura Jila Sardamoni Mohila Mahavidyalaya. As a good teacher, her popularity is not limited to the college boundary, but spread to the entire Bankura district. She obtained PhD degree from JNU in 2013. She had worked as research associate in JNU about 2 years on Himalayan cryosphere. She is interested in physical geography and remote sensing and GIS. She experts in water resource management, hydroclimatology, irrigation water management, climate variability and climate change, land use prediction and modeling, and glacial dynamics. Her today topic of lecturing is cryosphere studies in Indian Himalayas. I hope the session will be interactive and informative. Participants are requested to feel free to ask any topic related questions during the lecture session through our chat section, both Zoom and YouTube Live. Now I request Dr. Avira Dattorai for delivering her important lecture.
Thank you, Loki sir. Thank you, Devabrotu. And thank you, Principal sir, and everybody else in the organizing team. I hope I'm audible.
Yes.
Okay. It's really nice to meet all of you on this virtual platform. And when Loki sir approached me with giving a presentation or a lecture on this webinar, the first thing that came to my mind that during this lockdown period, there is a tsunami of webinars going on around in almost everywhere in India. So what I found that the topic on Himalayan cryosphere has not been touched upon at length, and especially in Bankura or at least in West Bengal, as far as my limited knowledge, the research in terms of cryosphere studies or studies related to glacier is very, very limited. Most of the studies that take place are outside West Bengal. There are a lot of specialized departments dealing with
Sorry, ma'am. Sorry, ek minute. Ma'am, please headphone tech to properly use COVID. Please.
Shona jacche na?
Okay. Ha. Now yes. Now clear.
Okay. So do I need to repeat? I don't want to repeat this almost a lot of.
No. Right. So.
What I was telling that because there is lack of research work or department related to cryosphere studies in West Bengal, I.
Sorry, ma'am. Hello?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
Ma'am, you are not audible sometimes. Your headphone problem, I think. Okay. Repeat once, please. Last part.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Now clear.
So what I was telling that because of paucity of or lack of proper infrastructure or funds, there is a problem that there is lack of research, and especially in West Bengal. So in order to give an overview, am I clear right now?
Yes, ma'am.
So in order to give an overview about the scope of study that can take place the stream of glaciology, I have made this presentation.
Ma'am, Ma'am, again facing same issue.
Maybe I'm speaking now
clear, ma'am. It's okay. Better.
Okay, so I'll speak a little slowly. So
Okay.
So as I was telling, that this presentation is completely dedicated towards giving an exposure about the kind of research that can be done in glaciological studies. So I would like to request share the slide, because I'm using hotspot, so there can be problems related to presenting my there can be problems that my system.
Ma'am, please, you not, please request to use properly headphone, please.
I'm using properly only. Can you hear me?
Yes, now clear.
Okay. So, what I'm telling is, Debabruta, can you please share the PPT? I'll begin my presentation.
Okay.
Okay, so this is a study on, this is the topic is cryosphere studies in Indian Himalaya. Can we go to the next slide? In graduation level, whatever you study is books related, especially Kabindra Singh, that we have consulted in our life. So, am I audible? There are some.
Yes. Yes, okay. You're audible.
Okay. So, in our student life, we had. Consulted books like Savitra Singh and some others to look into the glacial geomorphology, where we have studied about different valley glaciers, different moraines, pluvioglacial landforms. But to visit a glacier is not a very frequent practice among researchers, especially in West Bengal. Now, I have come to, even my knowledge was also very limited. What I came to know about in details was as a research in this project, which was in the university consortium on cryosphere and climate change.
Ma'am, can't hear.
Not audible?
Yes, now audible.
Till yesterday, everything was fine, but okay, let's see. So, in inter-university consortium project,
please, one minute, ma'am. Request to all the participants, please mute yourself from your end.
Ma'am, connect your headphone jack very well. Ma'am, please check your headphone jack.
Yes, I have. So, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible now.
Okay.
Maybe because of too much network load, my voice is cracking. So, I was a project fellow, a research associate, a postdoctoral fellow in this project that is Inter-University Consortium on Cryosphere and Climate Change in JNU. It was a mega project that was funded by DST, and as you can see that the Department of Science and Technology had initiated this program. It was an 18 crore program, and the consortium was between Jawaharlal Nehru University, Jammu University, Kashmir University, and Sikkim University. So these four universities had tied up to look into remote creators in different parts of central, western, and eastern Himalayas. So here are some photographs that I have shared. Now, people who are interested in studying about glaciology or glaciers can see different institutes that I'll be sharing with you. Devabrata, can you go to the next slide?
Sure.
Yeah, the next one, the one with India's map. Yeah, so these are the different institutes in which the glaciology related studies are taking place. If anyone is interested, they can apply for higher studies, research, MPhil or PhD in glaciological studies across India. So the some of the important centers are Wadia Institute of Himalayan Geology, Indian Institute of Remote Sensing, that is located in Dehradun, G.V. Pant Institute of Himalayan Geology and Environment and Development, JNU, Jammu Kashmir University, Devija Center for Climate Change, and many more. IIT Roorkee, National Institute of Hydrology in Roorkee. These there are specialized departments of geology, geography, where one can apply for future studies in glaciology. So even if we see the literature across Science Direct, Willy, or Taylor Francis, where most international publications related to glaciology takes place, those publications belong to these institutes that you see listed here. Devabrata, you can go to the second slide, the one with yes. I'll tell you to play it later. Okay. Now, why are we studying glaciology? Devabrata, can you pause the video?
Yes, ma'am. Hello, ma'am.
Yeah. So what I was telling is I think the video has not got paused. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, ma'am.
Okay. Now, why are we doing glaciological studies so much? Because the increased temperature and global warming are leading to either lesser precipitation and less snowfall, or are leading to more ablation or dissolving of the ice sheets. So that is why it is very important to know what factors are leading to the changing glacial sizes and how we can mitigate it. So here we are seeing a video where we want to look into ELA, that is equilibrium line of altitude. Now, the equilibrium line of altitude is one of the most important factors required. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, but your coming sound from your end really low.
The equilibrium, am I audible?
Yes, better. Yes, better.
The equilibrium line of altitude that we will be studying, which is one of the most important aspect of glacial studies, needs to be lower. So if there is higher accumulation of snow, then the equilibrium line altitude will be at a lower elevation, and if there is more melting of the snow, the line of the equilibrium line altitude is upwards.
Ma'am, please hold your microphone in your hand, please, ma'am.
Yeah, I'm holding my microphone.
Yes, this is a better position.
Yeah. So if you see the video that is being played on the screen, it's a new equilibrium line is shown and the old equilibrium line is also shown.
Ma'am, not audible you.
Oh God.
Now, not better.
Okay. I will speak a little slower. Now, if there is the equilibrium line altitude, line of altitude shifts lower, then there has been more
activity. Hello? Yes? Apni headphone ta khule use kor bolun to ekbar please.
Ma'am, computer.
Better.
इक्विलिब्रियम लाइन ऑफ ऑल्टीट्यूड शिफ्ट्स अपवर्ड दैट मीन्स द स्नो मेल्ट और द ग्लेशियर मेल्ट हैज हैपेंड टू अ ग्रेटर एक्सटेंट सो द ग्लेशियर रिसीव्स So the ELA line is very, very important. It's absolutely like a bank deposit that is being shown in this animation. Here what we see is if I am not able to deposit more money in my bank, then definitely my balance will reduce. So here the equilibrium line altitude, once the ablation or the melting of the glacier the ablation of the melting of the glacier will increase, there will be loss of snow, there will be loss of water, and the equilibrium line of altitude or ELA will move upwards, and that is a bad sign. So here, now I think you can have understood why ELA is important. Please change the slide, Devabroto.
Yes.
Now here is the literature review screenshots that I have been sharing. I have mentioned earlier as well. If we see the Science Direct, Taylor Francis, Willy Online Library, or Springer, there if we search Himalayan glaciers, the word Himalaya and the word glacier is being used. So it is showing around 2,692, or somewhere it's showing 300, somewhere more than 3,000 or 2,000 articles. But mainly it is comprising of both works on Himalaya related to other aspects also, and works on glaciers related to aspects other than Himalayas. But if we really go into the depth of the literatures, we'll see hardly 500 notable work has been done on Himalayan glaciers. So one of the few benchmark work that has been done is by GLIMS, that you can see in the print on your screen, is Global Land Ice Measurement from Space. This is a portal where you can get glaciology related or glacier related data that has been computed using remote sensing and GIS. There is another website that is ICMOD, you can see below. It is International Center for Integrated Mountain Development. This the headquarters is situated in Nepal, and the am I audible?
Yes, very well, ma'am.
Great, I'm happy. So this center in Nepal, ICMOD, is a big opportunity for geographers to look for jobs. It not only studies about glaciers, but it also studies about livelihood aspect, socio-economic aspects related to, impact of climate change, impact of landslides, earthquakes, lot of things. It's an international NGO. So people who are interested in applying for jobs related and interested to visit places which are wow, so they can definitely apply in IC Mod. One of my juniors in JNU was also working in IC Mod. Now he has shifted to Sussex, but he was working in population stream, but he was working in IC Mod. So this is a wonderful opportunity if you can apply here. There is a large scope for geographers in this platform. So Devabrata, please change to the next slide. So I have already told about it. So this is the slide where I'll be discussing about the dimensions in which glaciological studies can be done. You can look into the recession pattern, whether a snout of a glacier is progressing or whether it is receding back. You can look into various impacts of climate change, whether the snow area accumulation, snowfall over a glacial valley is increasing or decreasing, whether what kind of geomorphological studies can be done, like, you know, weathering takes place, it's very cold, and sometimes when there is, you know, high albedo or the rock layers trap sunlight, there is the frost action that leads to disintegration of rocks. And then there are debris fall, there are talus cones, there are moraines, drumlins, such beautiful landforms that can be very well studied in glaciological dimensions. Then there is sedimentology. You can date glacier moraines to know what happened in the last ice age. Where was the position of the glacial snout thousands and thousands of years back? So you can date using carbon dating techniques, which I'll be discussing. You can even use TLOSL dating techniques, luminescence dating techniques in glaciology to understand whether the glacial stream, the ice melt stream that is coming out from the glaciers, like near Gangotri, we are in Gomukh, we have Ganga emerging from Gomukh. So there used to be ancient settlements near those meltwater streams. So we can even find such archaeological evidences. So there's study of glaciology is very, very interesting. And I would like to thank the IUCCC team where I was working in the research project for giving me this exposure. I'm really thankful to the entire team. And then we can also study about ice velocity, the mass of the glacier, the speed at which the glacier is moving. We can look into the depth, because if you visit Himalayan glaciers, they are absolutely different from alpine glaciers like Alps glaciers in Switzerland. They are at a lower altitude, there are less debris. If you go to Himalayan glaciers, it's very difficult to trek because huge boulders are lying on the glacier. So you can study them, and you can also look into the mass balance, the permafrost area, the changes in runoff resulting from increased melting of the glaciers, and how this increased runoff or decreased runoff, whatever happens to certain glaciers, affect the downstream villages situated near those springs, or people in especially Himachal Pradesh, Lahore, Spiti, they use they channelize this meltwater stream for irrigation purpose. So how their livelihood, their agriculture is being affected as a result of such melting or runoff changes. You can also look into avalanches, hazards, and GLOF. So there is a huge diversity of study that can take place if you take glaciology as your specialization. So Devabrata, can we shift to the next slide?
Yes.
Yes. So here, as a student in graduation or in post-graduation, you must have learned about two or three classifications of glacier. There is a main glacier, there's mountain glacier and valley glacier, there's hanging valley glacier, or there is a cirque glacier. But there's huge like different types of classification based on the type of snout, where the glacial is pouring into, whether it's pouring into a lake or whether it is pouring in sea, the shape, size, the longitudinal profile. So there are different types of glacial classification. So the primary class that you can see is there is continental sheets, which you know, like those in Antarctica and Arctic region. There are ice caps, there's outlet glaciers, there's valley glacier, there's snowfield glacierets, very small glaciers, which I'll be showing you in Google Earth images later on in the slides. Then there's Sir glacier, the glacier that is just limited to the Sir from where it origins. Then the glaciers in craters. Then there's ice fall on the basis of longitudinal profile. There is jumps in the glacier, there's cascading glacier, then regular glaciers. There are calving glacier, lobed glaciers. Lobed glaciers are mainly like a tongue-shaped one with lot of debris covered in it. The tongue is not very, peak type or triangulated, rather has a very, curvy edge or U-shaped edge. There are debris-covered glaciers, there are clear glaciers, and there are a lot other classifications which you can see. This classification is one of the pioneer works done by Rana and Srivastav from GSI, Geological Study of India, and there is a very good book on which in, the 1980s, 90s, he, with his team of geologists, had traveled to different glaciers in the Himalayas with very little equipment, and yet had created a huge glacial inventory during those times. So it's very good. So you can definitely refer to that book. Now, next slide, Debabhuti. Okay. Now I'll come to the application part. I'll give you some overviews about how you can work in glaciers. Now, all these things were learned by me during the project. Now, for delineating a glacier, I'm audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, for delineating a glacier, it is very important that we should have a watershed or a basin for our consideration, and then find out what glaciers are there. In the top image, you can see yellow polygons on a Google Earth image. They were created on first using DEM, digital elevation models. You can take SRTM DEM, you can take raster DEM, and using that DEM in ArcGIS, you can also use other open source software like QGIS. The internet is full of resources. You can even explore on your own how to convert these DEMs into watershed boundaries. So first, using a DEM, you have to create a fill DEM. There are some voids in a DEM. You have to create a fill DEM option. You just type in YouTube that I want to create a watershed, delineate a watershed from a DEM. So in ArcGIS. So you will get an entire YouTube instruction video. So I've not shared those here. So you will first make a fill, then you will make a flow direction, flow accumulation map, and then you can generate a basin map. Those basin maps need to be converted into KMZ or KML file. Only those two formats of file are supported by Google Earth. Now, once you open those files, you can see that the picture below that is shown in this slide, that they fall exactly on the glacial valleys, and then you can do on-screen digitization using these high resolution images. Now, identifying a glacier or even identifying the snout of a glacier requires training your eyes, and that needs years of experience, years of thorough study in literatures, and then only you can correctly identify. So I have to go through a lot of iterations and a lot of correction in order to properly know how to identify a glacier. Now, I'll be sharing with you a way how on screen you can digitize a glacier using just simple Google Earth, which is available to all of you. Now, next slide, Debabrata, but don't play the video. Don't play the video right now. Let me explain. Now, delineating a glacier, as I told you, you can do it based on Landsat data, IRS, LIS data, a lot of other multispectral data, but their resolutions are very less. So that can lead to a lot of errors in your delineation. So most of the literatures that I have cited above has used either CartoSat data or high resolution data like QuickBird or Sentinel in order to delineate a glacier. Now, for creating glacial inventory, that is the most and the basic important thing that we need, that we have to first identify the glacial area. Only if we identify the glaciers, we can count the number of glaciers present in India and whether we can see whether they are shrinking or they have completely become, you know, dead ice over a period of time. We can use, corona images that are like aerial images. You can get them in USGS Earth Explorer. You just need to georefer them and put them in position to see and do a temporal change analysis to see the changes in snout position. So one of the most cheapest and visually, easily understandable ways of delineating a glacier is by using Google Earth. So here I have shared a video by which you can understand how it's done. Debabrata, please play the video. Is the video not playing, Debabrata?
Yes, ma'am.
Is the video not playing? Okay. Is it audible to the audience, the video?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Hello, ma'am. You have to explain, please. Not audible to audience. You have to explain.
Okay. Let's let the video play. Then I'll explain.
Okay.
Please play the video. Okay, I have typed a glacier peak name, that is Dhar Gundhar, and it is taking us to that peak. Now you will see how by using a polygon and polygon option in Google Earth, we can digitize a glacier. You are able to see the Sirk Glacier, the Main Valley Glacier, various geological landforms as well.
Hello.
Yes, Debabrata.
Yes, ma'am.
This is the cloud that you can see. The meltwater stream is coming out of the snout, and on both the sides you can see the lateral moraine. The lateral moraine is very high. We have not, if you visit in the field, it's at least in some places two-story building high. So that is how huge lateral moraines can form. I've taken a polygon option and I'm making it outlined in order to see whether I'm going in the right direction or not. You should always remember that you should not consider the moraine inside the glacial area. It may contain ice, but you should not consider the moraines. Here you can see the cirques, the Burke's chunt that is on the head wall, the final crack on the head wall of the glacier, and you have to consider the boundary till the Burke's chunt and not beyond that. You can see how I'm taking the line along the Burke's chunt throughout the glacial cirque. Has the audio been paused, a video been paused, Devabrata? turn the Google Earth 3D, likewise, in order to get a proper view. So this is how you can delineate a glacier, and you have to be very careful about the snout position. You can see the crevices, the cracks on the glacier body, the meltwater stream, the various slopes, the hanging valley, glacier here. Okay, so I think to people who, to whom this video was not audible, Devaruta, just go. This slide is fine. So to people who to whom the audio was not audible, to them, I'm telling that I had swiped the historical images in order to see whether I get a clearer glacial valley image or not. Because in case there is no cover, you won't be able to identify the real and the actual extent of the glacier. Now, that was the way in which I think it has been clear to you by that how we can, by using Google Earth, delineate the glacial boundaries. So there are so many glacial boundaries. They're like, you know, just in Sikkim itself, there are over 450 glaciers, which has not been studied in details. So there is ample scope to do research in the field of glaciology. Now, other than doing a manual digitization, there are other ways as well in which you can digitize or you can extract glacial features or glacial bodies. Some of the works I have already mentioned in this slide has been done by Suresh Dash and Mirabchand Sharma. Sharma sir was our project in charge in which I was working. And Suresh was my junior in JNU. I think he is pursuing his PhD there right now. So these are some pioneer works. Now, if you are not able or if you want to try to identify glaciers from not only from Google Earth, but from other sources as well, you can use multispectral data. Now, even like GLIMS, the one I had talked about earlier, the global ice measurement system that they had created, even GLIMS had tried to identify. Am I audible?
Yes, yes. Please request all the participants, please mute yourself from your end, please.
So, even GLIMS has used multispectral data, corrected it with after they have extracted the glacial bodies using multispectral images, they have corrected it using high resolution images later on. But how can you use a multispectral image in order to identify a glacier? There is a band ratioing technique used. You can see that in this slide, there is a B res by B square, short wave infrared band. So if we do a band ratioing technique, which I'll also show you how to be conducted in ELDAS, you can also do it in other open source software as well. You just need to explore. So using this band ratioing technique, like visible divided by shortwave infrared, you can use sometimes green band or sometimes red band and use a square band and identify glacial bodies. And you will see that because they are being done on a raster image, what happens is you can see an image just below where you can see that there is step-like features that the boundary has formed like this, where it's written crevices and given an arrow mark there you can see. So there's a red step-like line going. So that also leads to error. So just calculating glacial boundary based on either Google Earth or even using multispectral data are not always absolutely free from errors. There are errors, but we can generalize and even come to some conclusive evidences as to what is happening to these glaciers. Now, here in this slide, you can also see two pictures on your right hand. One has in mobile, I don't think it will be very clearly visible, but what is done is in a season, in a summer month, stacks, bamboo stick, you can take bangshet, danda or any danda, if you want any bamboo stick, and just, press it inside the glacier to a glacial tongue to a greater depth so that it is stable. Now, glaciers are huge, massive bodies. So when they move, the entire, bamboo stick or whatever, stick you put inside will move along with the glacier. Now, one season, you go to that field, you put in a bamboo stick and take the GPS reading. This is the latitude, longitude where I have put the bamboo stick. Now, after 2 or 3 years, you come back and you see that where your bamboo stick is, until and unless anybody or Yeti comes and moves it away. If you go and check whether the bamboo stick is there or not, you will see that it has shifted. Or else if the glacier has a huge meltout, then maybe it will flow away. So you have to make position in such a way that the glacier, there is not a much meltout. Now, once you again take the GPS reading of that bamboo stick that has shifted a little bit, you can even understand and calculate the rate or velocity in which the glacier is moving. You can also analyze the rate and velocity in which the glacier is progressing or there has been a recession. So this is one of the field work that can be done. Another picture that I have given just below on your right hand side, where A and B and marking is given, these are photographic evidences. People who had visited in the 1970s, 80s have taken the photographs of snout positions and then When you visit, you take the photography position and you match them. You see how much there has been change in the position of the snout. So in this way, you can also identify ways in which glacier has receded or progressed. So these are very few cheap or inexpensive techniques. Now, next slide, Devabrata. Go to the slide where I have shown Google Earth mapping of glacial snout.
This one?
I think this one, yes.
Can I play?
No, not this one.
This one?
Previous to this? Not this one. It chaliye dekho. It aged slide ta.
Just a minute.
Ha, this one. This is the one. Just start from the beginning. Yes. So this is where this is. I'm showing you how Gomukh has receded based on your visual interpretation techniques using Google Earth 3D. This is Dhar Gundhar. We had just in the previous video we had digitized. Now we'll shift to Gomukh. We have zoomed into Gomukh. Now I would like to take an historical image of some past year. So the red line was of 2020. It is of 2020 actually, the present. And the yellow line is of 2010. You can see how much Gangotri Glacier has shifted or receded back. Okay.
Sorry,
so
sorry.
From the previous video, you have seen that how the change in the snout position can be shown, can be done using glacier, using Google Earth. So it's a very useful technique. You can even try or it on your own. You can make inventories of your own, take out good publications. So this is such an easy way to do so. So that is the way we can do the mapping of snout positions. Now, here in this slide, we will be mapped. Here I have shown that Satya Prakash and again Nilabchand Sharma and Pritam Chand in the group in IUCC had mapped the Menthosa Glacier, which is a part of Miad Valley, located in Lahaul Spiti in Himachal Pradesh. They have used cartoset images, stereo pair images, created a high resolution digital elevation model. Using those images, they have made very good field visits, because otherwise it's very difficult as a person who is not trained to identify drumlins or identify a lateral moraine, a recessional moraine, a scree. So you can see there are in the slide in the legend that they have mapped slump, the glacial valley, the scree, the talus cones, the debris cones, the lateral moraine, the medial moraine, the recessional moraine, snow covered area, crevices, rock glacial paths, dry channels, glacial lakes. So many features have been identified by them. So one, I said that you can use cartosat stereo pair to create a high resolution digital elevation model. You have to procure, pay for to NRSC to get a cartosat stereo image, and then generate it. There are videos available in YouTube as to how to generate a stereo pair as well. So using those and using Sentinel data or any high resolution data, and with the help of field visit, they were able to digitize and map the geomorphological features in Lahaul and Spiti, this Menthosa Glacier. And there is also a technique by which even these people have also used in this paper, the ways to map a geomorphological feature using Google Earth. So we'll see how it is done in the next video. Devabrata, please play the next video. So we are going to Menthosa Glacier. Maybe I am saying something in this video. I think Devabrata, can you increase the audio of this?
But no, map, yeah. It's not streaming on YouTube.
Okay.
Only I can hear it.
Just then fast forward the video.
Okay.
It's possible. Yes, here we are going to the Menthosa Glacier, which the map of which I have just shown. So this is completely ice covered. And it is at an elevation of around 4,607 meters. You can see Urgos. It's a settlement where we had our base camp. Was a village where we also had conducted our socio-economic survey as well to look into how the meltwater stream from this Menthosa Glacier is contributing into the apple cultivation, apple orchards in this valley. So here we have got a image which is cloud-free as well as free from fresh snow cover. And you can see the glacial moraines, the glacial lake, which I'll be just digitizing in a while. Can you see, I suppose you can see the sky blue color lake. Yes, this is the glacial lake. You can use a polygon to digitize the glacial lake. These are supraglacial lakes that are formed. The different types of glacial lakes, which I'll be discussing in my later slides as well. On both the sides of the slope, you can see talus cones. You can save your KMZ file in this manner in Google Earth. Some of you must be aware of how to do it. But still, for people who have not used these features, I'm explaining. There is another glacial lake which you can digitize. Very easy to do. You can also on the right hand see some lobes or, you know, some creases, as you see crease occurs on in clothes which are not kept properly. So while the glacier moves, it takes the debris with it along with it. So there are creases that forms on the glacier. So this is the moraine, which you can see. The cirques on the top. And this is how, using a line attribute, you can digitize a moraine. Even while digitizing the moraine, you can see the changes in the elevation from the right-hand bottom corner in Google Earth, where you can see the changes happening 4,443 meters, then 4,370 meters. So this is how you can even get the elevation of a moraine from the local sea level. So this is how you can digitize different glacial features. I've shown you a line attribute, a polygon attribute. I think it's clear to you all. You can try out, you can read more literatures. There are empty literatures available in Science Direct, Elsevier, Springer, Taylor Francis. I'll ask you to refer to the journals in the portals I have prescribed, because they are under UGC CARE list. If you're interested in publishing your article in good journals, please do that. These are the cracks and crevices that you can see. You can even digitize them using line attribute. Yeah, you can see the arides, the pyramidal peaks, and the aridity, which you can also digitize using line attributes. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, ma'am. Very well.
Yes, ma'am.
Are the participants enjoying? Are they feeling bored?
No, ma'am.
Can anyone share in the chat? Is it okay?
Yes, ma'am, it is very interesting topic. Please carry on.
Thank you so much. Yes, Devabrata, I think you can pause and we can move to the next slide. Yes. So here, I've shown here the ways of computing ELA or equilibrium line altitude. As in the very first video where I had shown you some animations, I had discussed with you that ELA or equilibrium line of altitude is a very important component in order to understand whether the glacial mass is decreasing, whether there is much meltdown, or whether there is more snowfall and the ice accumulation is more. So there are different ways in which you can compute the ELA. One is Thar method. What is Thar? Thar is toe to head altitude. Sorry for the spelling mistake. Toe to head altitude, and the formula is maximum glacial elevation height, maximum height of the minimum height of the glacier, that will be definitely the snout position. So we'll take those two positions and divide it by two. One option is that you take the head, the topmost head wall elevation value, and then take the elevation value of the snout position, add it, and divided it by 2. You will get a value that will be definitely in meters, some 4,000, 5,000 meters, and that would be the equilibrium line of altitude or ELA. Now, when you take this option, it will come to your mind, how to get the altitude here? So how to get? Definitely digital elevation model, topo sheet maps, and field investigation will give you the data. Now, going to the head wall of glacier is not very feasible for, you know, aam aadmi like us. You have to be a very trained mountaineer, and even like different universities, especially in JNU, we have a mountaineering club where people who go for such field work are trained to move, trek uphill. So people do go up, but it's not a feasible option. You can stay home and even calculate the changes in ELA. So how can it be done? Devabrata, please play the video by using DEM. I'll explain. So you can mute here, you can lower the volume of the video, I'll explain. By using the digital elevate, on-screen digitization technique in Google Earth, I had digitized the boundary of the glacier. Now this then converted the KMZ file into shapefile. You will get a number of videos on that, how to do it. So I'm not going into that details. So after you get the shapefile, you download an Aster DEM. Here I have downloaded an Aster DEM, and or you can take SRTN DEM as well, or a Carpo DEM, whatever is suitable for you. Then clip it or mask it. Now you see how I am doing it. I've gone to ArcTools. I have the shapefile or the outer boundary, which has got superimposed on the digital elevation model. Then in ArcTools, I've gone to Spatial Analysis Tools, extract by mask. There I have given the input raster as the DEM and the dice that will cut out, like a cookie cutter, the dice, the shapefile, and then give an output file name in the output raster option. Is the video playing, Devabrata? Yeah, I'm giving the output raster name here. Glacial E is the output raster name, and I press OK. The process gets done. So I have the DEM cut out in the shape of my glacier. So that is the area that I want. See? Fine. So here you can see on the left hand side in the panel that the glacier underscore E has two values. The minimum value is 4,320 and the maximum value is 6,568 meters. What? You know the formula of Thar. So in the formula here, what we do? 6,568 plus 4,320 divided by 2. You'll get a value that is, I think, 5,444 meters. Yes. Now, I said ELA is a line. Where do I get the line? I have just got the value. So there are ways to get the line or the contour line as well. So how to get it? I'll again go to ArcTools. You see the video. In 3D Analyst, we have raster surface option. Where I go to contour list, I input the raster file, that is the file that I have just cropped out, and give an output name for the shape file that is in polyline, because contour will be in polyline option. So I write ELA thar, that is the polyline that will come out, and give the value 5000444 and get the process done. And you'll see a line has appeared, which is in light blue, and I have converted into dark red. I think everyone can see this is the ELA line for this glacier on the date this Aster Dam was captured, or from the image, the Aster Dam has been calculated. So you can take a dam of another date and again see whether the ELA has moved upward or downward, and then you can state whether the glacier is receding or whether it is progressing. So this is the way how we can compute the glacier ELA. I think it's done. Next slide. Just give me a second. Yeah, sorry, I had a phone call. I had to switch off. Is this the next slide, Debabrata?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So here, what we are doing, we also use, now I have shown you till now the analysis that can be done on glaciology with free of cost. Now we'll come now shift a little bit towards cost intensive, or usage of very high end equipments which may cost around lakhs, ranging from 1 lakh to 18 lakh and a lot more. So here there is a publication again by Pavan Kumar, one of my juniors in JNU, and Milab Sharma sir, where we have used total station. Total station here has been used to map the Gangotri snout. Here you can see the entire team. The red shirt was jumper is Milab Sharma. Then there is Umar, one of my fellow research associates. They had trekked all the way from Uttarakhand to reach Gangotri or Gomukh, and they had done a total station mapping. And they have formed a 3D map, which is shown below in the slide, showing what the Gomukh looks like. Now you may ask, what is the use of getting a 3D map? The use is that you can see the changes in the undulation of the face of Gomukh. There can be volumetric changes. So GPR, also some people are questioning GPR, I'll be discussing it later. It is ground penetrating radar that also we'll be using and how, in what ways we can use, I'll discuss it later. So we will get a 3D map using a total station model. Now we can see the changes in the face of the glacier, whether you know somebody punches my face, so kya ho gaya, kala pad gaya ki nahi. So in that similar way, what has been the face of the snout? So 1 year I'm doing a total station mapping. The next year we can see the changes in the undulation, which face of the snout has melted the most and why. Are there are more debris covers on that part which has melted the most, or whether it is more exposed to sunlight? So there are different attributes in which this massive you know, it's the Gomukh. I don't know whether you guys have visited or not. It's like huge 3 to 4 story high glacial snout, and if you stand near the snout, the trickle or droplets of water will fall, and that leads to the formation of the Ganges. So that is the applicability of total station, and you need to have trained experts. You need your institution to purchase a total station, or even you can rent in different places. Different organizations are there, by the help of which you can map these glaciers. Now, next slide.
Just a minute. Please request to all the participants, please mute yourself.
So someone is talking. Chalo, koi baat nahi. Now, other than that, we can also use various other satellite images in order to look into the changes in snow accumulation and snow cover or changes in the permafrost area. So you can type in YouTube. I think I've given a link as well. I'll ask the organizers to share this PPT and the videos to you as well. You can even do a change detection of the snow accumulation, whether there has been an increased snowfall or a decreased snowfall using using MOD-10A2 data. That is MODIS data, which is pre-prepared. You have to do nothing. Just download the data, download temporal data starting from 2002 onwards, from when the MODIS data is available until present, and then carry out your work. How to carry out your work, I'll tell you. Here I've given the link as to how you can download your data. You have to go to this Reverb website. I have given the link below in this site, and then use the second option. You can select the area where you want to get the MODIS data downloaded. Then you will get a lot of granules, like cells, which you want to download. You have to log in, create a registration ID for that, and then you can download your data. They'll be sending you a link in your mail, and from that you can download. Now, from there you can see the changes in snow cover area. So, Devo, go to the next slide, please. Yeah. So here in this slide, I have written down how to analyze the snow cover from MODIS data. Now, on the right hand side, you can see a map showing the trend line of change in snow cover area. Now, here the two maps that are shown, the violet, yellow, blue, and violet one, is of Menthosa Glacier that we had generated for the project in IU Tetra C. And the other green one is Gangspan Glacier. JNU had worked on four glaciers: Menthosa, Gangspan, Rudugera, and Palapani Glacier. So what we had done, downloaded MODIS 10 snow product, and then all the MODIS data are in sinusoidal projection. Okay, so in we have to convert it into UTM WGS 84 north projection in order to get the required area, because it will be in meter square, so sinusoidal projection won't be able to give us the correct information. So you have to reproject the entire image. Then the data what you get is we get three formats, like three data in once you download. One will be the snow cover data, the other will be a fractional snow cover data, and the third one will be snow albedo. So from that also a lot of research can be done. I will request you all to explore those. Now, in the snow cover data which I'm right now talking about, the entire data or the raster cells or the pixels are given few numbers. Zero means data is missing. One means no decision, like, because a group of team working with LabDAC, NASA, and EROS or USGS have been working on the raw data, level one data, and has given us in the portal a processed data. We just need to download and take out, extract our area and calculate the information. So what they have done, they have coded the information. So we have to know there with whatever data. If you go to those websites, there is an ATBD file, algorithmic file, PDF file, in which the entire process has been explained. And here, from there you can understand that what code means what. So zero means missing data, one means no decision, there may be cloud cover or there may be some algorithmic problem that for that pixel, no decision was obtained. 11 means it's like nighttime data. 25 number, code 25 of the raster cell means there is no snow in that place. 37 means there is lake. 39 is ocean. suppose you have downloaded a map of Arctic or Antarctic or some ocean area has come under your study. So 39 will be a code. That means that falls under oceanic body. So 100, if there is glacial lake, then there will be 100. And 200 is the raster pixel that you need to identify your snow cover area. So you have to take only those pixels that belong to the code 200. And then 50 is cloud cover, so it's of no use. These data, snow MODIS data, are available on a daily basis, on an annual, monthly basis, and even on an 8-day composite. So whatever ways you need, you get the data. You extract your area. Now you know how many pixels are there. So each and every pixel are of 500 meter dimension, 500 meter square, 500 by 500. So if you have 3 pixels in your area, which are under snow cover, 3 into 500. So you'll get 1500 meter square. That is the area covered under snow for your study area. So like this, you can compute snow cover under different areas. You can do studies in Darjeeling, Siliguri, Gangtok, wherever you like, using those data and get good publications. Now, another thing you'll see in the bottom of the slide, that is NDSI, Normalized Difference Snow Index. There are other indices too, Normalized Difference Glacier Index, Snow Index for different other satellite images as well. Here in a video, I'll show you how to compute NDSI. Now, why is an NDSI required? NDSI is required for people who want to get a better resolution of the snow cover area. So 500 meter by 500 meter is a very crude pixel. So I need a better spatial resolution. So for that, I'll take a Landsat image, which has a 30 meter pixel spatial resolution. I can pan sharpen it with a panchromatic band in it. Landsat 8, Landsat 7 has panchromatic bands. You can pan sharpen and get a resolution up to 15 meter pixel. So you'll get a better and a very fine resolution data from that. So for computing or calculating snow area on a multispectral image, we need to have NDSI. And here I'll be showing you in this video how to compute NDSI using ADAS. Debabruto, can you please play the video? No, it was in the previous slide. Yeah, this one. You can mute the audio of the video and I'll then speak.
Already muted, ma'am.
Okay. So here what I have done is I have taken a layer stack image or merged image, a false color composite image. If you don't know how to generate a false color composite, you can search YouTube, okay? So here I've taken a false color composite image. These are the glaciers in Sikkim. And I'll be applying NDSI on it. Now you go to help. There are other ways also in which you can find indices, but this is a shortcut that I would like to find out. So I'll go to help, type indices, and we'll type indices, and we'll then go to indices option. Now a pop-up window comes out, in which you can see the input image file is layer stack. Because it's already open in your background, it will automatically take the input image. Okay, so it will take layer stack, and then you see the sensor here is shown as Landsat 4, but while I have actually used Landsat 8 OLI. Now I'll change it into Landsat 7 because I have not merged all the bands. I have not layer stacked all the bands. There is cirrus clouds band, there are coastal aerosol bands, and there's panchromatic band that I have not merged. Now here I take NDSI from the drop down option, given output name, it will by default take the formula that is visible minus MIR divided by visible plus MIR, and then get it. The process will be done and you will get a output map. get the output done. So that's why I paused the video and recorded it and again started. So now I'll open the NDSI map, which is available in recent. So this is the NDSI map. Now I'll zoom in and you can see the glaciers, and I'll be flickering the image switch on and off in order to show that the debris covered glaciers are visible. On the right, you can see the cloud cover. On the peaks, you can see the fresh snow cover. The red areas are vegetation, some brown areas that are bare rocks. So you can see all these things here. Now, it's very difficult from the NDSI map, which is in panchromatic condition, to visually interpret whether there is snow or there is a glacier. So it's because it's in all gray shades. So even there are glacial lakes also, which you'll be seeing. Is the video paused, Devu? Something has changed. I can see. Devabruta, can you hear me? I'm unable to see the slide.
Yes, ma'am. Go ahead.
I'm unable to see the slide, so I won't be able to explain. Can you share the screen? I'm unable to see the screen. I can see your password and link and participant ID.
Hey, madam, it's off it a little.
Any problem, Hilsa? Devabruta, have you got disconnected? Okay, let me try. I'll try and share the video. I'm the host. I hope I have a problem with my hotspot, so my system can get hacked. Sorry if there is any interruption in between, but I'm trying to show you. So, Devabruta, whenever you will be visible, please do, like whenever you will be able to join, please do let me know. Okay, just a second.
Go ahead. Okay, ma'am, your slide is visible. Ma'am, please unmute yourself.
Yeah, actually there has been some electricity problem in Devabruta's place. So, is my slide visible to all
yes,
of you?
Slide is visible.
Okay, so here, now what I was talking about, I was sharing the video, right? I'll just play the video for you because I don't know whether my hotspot will hang or not. So this is how I was calculating the NDSI. Okay, is the audio in my video that I'm playing audible or not? Please let me know.
Sorry, ma'am, load shedding.
So I'll stop sharing. You share it, okay?
Okay.
Thank you to the participants for their patience. Am I taking too much time?
No, it's okay.
The video is in slide number 17. This one. Next to it. এরপর একটা হ্যাঁ এই ভিডিওটা চলছিল না না তার আগে নিচে যে কালো ম্যাম ভিডিওটা একটু ফাস্ট ফরওয়ার্ড করে দিন
ফ্রম হিয়ার
না এক তারও আগে হ্যাঁ এখানে so what I was saying that if I flicker the image, you can see that there are glacial lakes here and ice cover as well. So from the panchromatic, am I audible to all of you?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
So with the panchromatic band, the panchromatic NDSI image, it is not very permissible to analyze whether or not which is a glacier or which is a snow cover or which is a glacial lake. So in order to understand what is what, different literatures have shown that in order to know what is a snow cover, 0.3, in some cases 0.4 or 0.2 and even higher values can be used as a threshold value or a cutoff mark or a cutoff value to estimate the fresh snow cover from a multi-spectral image. Now here I have opened it in ArcGIS so that I can classify and give colors to the NDSI that I have calculated or I have computed out. I am giving false color composite to the layer stack image, and over that I have opened the NDSI. Now you can see the cloud cover like cotton patches, and here you can see the glacial lakes, the snow cover, and the glaciers as well, the rock cover, debris covered glaciers, the vegetation cover. So what I have done is I double clicked on NDSI and then gone to Symbology and given 15 classes and classified it. And as I have told you, different literatures have taken threshold as 0.2, 0.3. All the pixel values, if you have studied NDVI, NDWI, NDVI, after carrying out a band ratioing, all the pixels are given a value of from +1 to -1 range. So the threshold or the cutoff value here are either 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, and in my case, it will be 0.6. So here, the cutoff value is 0.6, and you see I have given 15 classes. I have given colors to the image and have taken classification. I have done the classification. Now, if you see the left-hand bar, left-hand side of the ArcGIS, the panel, layer panel, you see 0.6 and 0.733 are like violet to pink magenta color, and they overlap with the fresh snow cover. Can you see? I'm flickering the image, okay? And the values that are in blue color from 0.4 to 6 or 0.2 to 6, the blue shades are all the areas which are glacial lakes or melt water on the surface of the glacier. So those are under water bodies. You can also, in order to refine your classification, you can compute an NTWI, NTVI to omit out the vegetation patches, the water bodies, and just get the snow. For you, for that, you have to do raster calculator and other modeling exercise in ADAS or ArcGIS. Now here you can see the cloud cover has come in, you know, fluorescent green. So that is from my the values range from minus 0.33 to you know, minus 0.06. So you can very well segregate water body from vegetation, from snow, from you know, cloud cover. Even though cloud top is also ice, but still this NDSI allows you to compute the snow cover area, and even the vegetation patches also can be you know, properly segregated. But in this case, there is a problem. The there is an overlap of, like, there are shadows, because the sun's angle is in a certain position, so the peaks cast a shadow on the next value. So that can often lead to some errors in your computation, and for that reason it's necessary to do a further cleansing of your data, or even taking multi-temporal images in order to get a better understanding. So if you take images from, suppose, Landsat TM and calculate NDSI and take from 1990s to till 2020, for every year, for a particular season, for a study area, you take the images, calculate the snow covered area, either from MODIS or from, you know, these multi-spectral images, and you can even plot, by calculating the area, you can plot it on the graph, as has been shown on the right hand side corner map. You can find whether the snow area is increasing in the in your study area or not. So this is how you can do a study of snow accumulation. Now next, come to the next video. Next slide. Now, even I think you're familiar with the photo that is shown on the right hand side top corner by now. By 2010-11, we were familiar with that photo. That is an infrared thermometer. Nowadays, because of the COVID-19, everyone is shooting this infrared gun at you to test your temperature, whether you are having fever or not, or you are a carrier of COVID-19. But that is an infrared thermometer that we had used long back, and nowadays you can even find it in Amazon. I think it may cost some 5,000-6,000. A lower version may cost cheaper, but ours was a higher version one with which gave us even the emissivity values as well. So that IR in a thermometer gun was used to detect temperature from any surface. Now you just shoot, press a button in the gun, and a laser ray will fall on the surface to which you are targeting, and the temperature on it will automatically get detected on the display screen, and even the emissivity values as well. So from that you can even understand whether the temperature condition on the snow surface, on the water surface, the lake, anything, whatever you want to, just don't target it to your eyes, or else you'll get blind. So that is one option. So using this, we can do a ground validation of the temperature condition of a surface in the glacial valleys. Now, other than that, we can use MODIS LST, which is a mod 11 data. In the similar way in which you can download MODIS 10, you can download MODIS 11 as well. You can get MODIS Landsat temperature data, and you can, I have given you YouTube links in which you can use either ArcGIS and ADAS to compute or get the information of pixel wise land surface temperature, whether the area is very cold or it's getting hotter. If you take temporal time scenes, you can even estimate the temperature. The estimates come generally in degree Kelvin, and then you can convert it into degree centigrade for your use. And then using the validation of IR thermometer, you can see how much the difference the MODIS
and the real-time data is giving, what difference you are getting. And you can even validate the data. So in this way, you can even find out whether in the glacial valleys, the temperature of the surface, the temperature of the ice cover, the glacial lakes are increasing or decreasing. And there are a large number of publications. One of the publications even, I am also, if you see the print screen on the above, even I was one of the authors in this publication where we had used MODIS LST to compute the temperatures of the surface in that glacial valley. And even because the project was highly funded, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Because I had just moved away from the laptop, so I thought maybe. So even because this project was highly funded, we got to set up an automatic weather station, which you can see here. Some of us, some of the participants is asking me, what is the instrument? It is an infrared thermometer gun, IR thermometer. Okay, so we can also set up, but it's very expensive. Until and unless we have a project funded or a collaborative effort by different universities can be taken up, it's difficult to install a AWS. Here, the AWS or the automatic weather station could come, you know, could measure the wind speed, the snow cover, the solar radiation, the you know, the snowfall, the temperature on you know, every second basis. And there was a server installed in JNU on the basis of a micro SIM. All the data used to go get transferred into the server system, where used to get the data on a daily basis and compute it and get, you know, do trend line analysis, whether there is increase in humidity, precipitation, snowfall, solar radiation. So n number of studies can be done. Now, if you do not have such weather station, they are also freely available downloadable temperature rainfall data on a gridded or pixel basis. You can try Aphrodite data, you can try TRMM data, you can also get daily gridded rainfall data or monthly gridded rainfall data. You have to purchase it from IMD. The cost is, I think, for entire India is around 5,000. You can ask your institution to purchase it. Even you can create an account there, they can supply data on a daily basis to you, do different kind of research work you want to, and yes, you can publish papers. Research is what we are looking for, and not just mugging up, you know, books that we have taught. So if you do such kind of work, I think it will be my success. Okay, next slide, Devabrutu.
Just a minute. Yeah,
great. So here we are seeing images. In this, the study here is on the basis of glacio-archaeological evidences, on dating, carbon dating, or even understanding tree ring, or dendrochronology, or understanding sediments. To analyze, as I had already told you earlier, that whether some kind of settlements were there during the early Holocene period near some glaciers. One of my fellow colleagues, he is now an assistant professor in Sagar University, Rakesh Saini. He went with us for his PhD work to this Miar Basin in Lahaul Spiti, and he found this beautiful, you know, dilapidated structures of villages of some time. So he collected wood pieces, charcoal, some ash deposited, and he collected them, and he had sent them to US. One of our fellow project member was Easton Barr. You can search his name in Science Direct. And he is, I think, a professor of Manchester University, Manchester Metropolitan University. Because of the collaboration, all these wood pieces were sent for carbon dating.
And it was found, you can see this his article that has come out in Anthropocene that I have cited, and the pictures are also there, that how, you know, these evidences can help us understand where the glacier used to exist in a paleoclimatic situation. So yeah, please, Devabrata, play the video in the previous slide. It will show you the process how carbon dating is done. Please louder the volume, because otherwise the lady who is speaking won't be able to. It won't be audible. In this slide, please louder the volume. Yeah. Is it audible to the participants?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Devabrata, should I try and play it from my system for a second? Let's see. Okay, the volume is really low.
But you're full, ma'am.
So here it is shown that carbon 14, which is an isotope of carbon, gets natural carbon, actually nitrogen 14 gets cosmic bombardment. I think some of you are aware about how. I'll send you the link of this video if you're not if it's not audible to you. Let me explain what is done here. Is because of cosmic bombardment, the nitrogen 14 is converted into carbon 14. And carbon 14 is inhaled by all living beings, maybe it's animals or plants or us. As long as we are living, as long as we are not dead, the carbon 14 keeps getting inside us through food, through respiration. And once we are dead, the carbon 14 starts decaying and we are no more inhaling carbon 14. Now, when carbon 14 starts decaying, the half-life of carbon, it starts decaying and it gets converted into other elements, carbon 12, etc. And when carbon 12 and carbon 14 are present in the atmosphere as well as in the human body or any living body in a certain proportion, so what happens is when we die, this carbon 14 starts decaying, and it has come, it has been researched that carbon 14's half-life is 5,730 years. Now, if I get a fossil or a cardboard or a wood, any organic matter that has carbon inside it, and we try to analyze and find out how much carbon 14 is present, and we see that the carbon 14 amount has become half in comparison to carbon 12, because I told both of them are in a constant ratio. Now, if carbon 12 is stagnant and carbon 14 was here, and carbon 14 has become half in comparison to carbon 12, then you can say that the body which you are examining, the fossil that you are examining, has is 5,730 years old. So this is how carbon dating is done. In this video, this lady has taken a sample of a cloth and has bleached it, has cut out a very small fragment of it, have undergone and seen the microscopic evidences, has bleached it and has gone into detailed processing through various instruments present in the lab. I wanted to show you what are the processings done. So I'll share the video with you because now it's not audible. And then, you know, after the cleansing processes and lot of, you know, chemical treatments, they got a very small quantity of carbon, which was analyzed in a computer stimulated machine. And they have got to know whether the P piece of cloth is an antique piece or it's a modern piece. What they found was the cloth is a very valuable antique cloth and should be restored. So this is how even you can analyze using, you know, carbon, bones, tree pieces, different, anything that has carbon inside, you can do carbon dating. But one of the limitations of carbon dating is that if any object is older than 50,000 years, the amount of carbon gets reduced to such an extent that you are unable to detect. There comes the role of TL and OSL dating, that is thermoluminescence dating or optical luminescence dating or infrared stimulated luminescence dating or even green light stimulated luminescence dating. So these are the various instruments, and I'll share with you these videos so that you can learn from this, and please try to explore rather than looking into Sushant Singh Rajput kab mara kya hua and all that things. Yeah, that is also a national topic, but I think you should even I do search what happened to Sushant Singh Rajput. But you can, as a geographer, try to look into these aspects and see the venues that that can be explored in this field, because they're so interesting. And I really feel that we need to have such kind of infrastructure, physical research laboratory in SAC, Space Application Center, Ahmedabad. Jammu has a carbon dating center, Jammu University or Kashmir University. TLOSN labs are there in Villa Sahani Institute of Paleobotany or Paleosciences. There are GSI has these facilities. If you want to get your data tested, you send your samples, spend some money, and then you can get evidences and publish papers. So yes, this is about carbon dating. Devabrata, please, can we shift to the next slide? You can pause the video and then shift to the next slide. Okay, so here is the image of the different TL and OSL dating processes and I-score dating processes as well. So luminescence based techniques are mainly divided into two types. One is thermal luminescence and the other is optical luminescence. Of optical luminescence, even there are two other divisions that I had already mentioned, that is green light stimulated luminescence and infrared light stimulated luminescence. Now what has to be done is that you have to take glacial tilts, glacial moraines, in order to see how, or even you can take lacustrine deposits as well, in order to see how we have to collect, in order to see what the glacial moraine dates back. Now, Devabrata, can you please play the video? Yeah, this is how, this video will show you how the core from a sediment strata or verb is collected. We generally have PVC pipes, or you can take steel pipes as well, and then hammer it inside the sediment layer of your interest. But you just don't hammer anywhere. Mainly take sand lenses, patches of sand, where you know that these areas have been exposed to sunlight at one point of time, and where the cosmic radiation has led to entrapment of electrons here, and see how they are hammering in the core, and then cover both ends of the core sample. Now, why is it necessary? It is necessary because the sediment that has been hidden under different other, superimposed layers should not be exposed to sunlight. Once it gets exposed to sunlight, your sample is destroyed. So it's very important that your core should be, especially the center of whatever you are sampling, should be inside that pipe. The other ends do get exposed to sunlight. Now, by taking this sample, we take it to a PLOSL laboratory. And what we do is we have machines to understand what are to know when was that particular piece of sediment or core of sediment was exposed to sunlight, and that can be millions of years back. And Devabrata, can you just pause and exit the video? I'll show them the schematic diagram. Yeah, so here you see the schematic diagram, and there are a few publications in by which the sampling has been tested and dates have been found. So we have a core sample. First, we take the sample. We take it to a dark room or a room which is very dim light. Generally, in JNU, we used to have a red color bulb, the dim bulb, and the night lamp that we use in our house. So that light is there. We take the sealed sample, sealed from both the ends, and we used to take them to the laboratory in the dark room. There we used to cut out the sample, take the area of interest, the piece we just need, remove the other parts that may have been contaminated, and then sieve it. You know, sieve shaker, many of the colleges and universities will be having sieve shaker and the chalni and the, you know, from where you have grain size segregation, you have automated sieve shakers with meshes made on the basis of segmenting silt and sand and other gravels from each other. Now, after the sieving is done, we need to segregate. A chemical treatment is done. There is even magnetic separations also done. Chemical separations are also done so that we can get the most abundant element on the earth, that is quartz or feldspar. So this quartz and feldspar, from that amount, a very small patch is taken. That is known as aliquot. These aliquots are then put inside this OSL dating machine, and it is given light rays. Like you can see in the picture here, there are two sides from which light rays are being thrown on the sample, such that the electrons in it get activated. Once the electrons in it gets activated, it starts jumping. And once they start jumping, the machine detects the activity and gives us the bit. So this is a very simple way in which I have explained, but it is a bit deeper. If you want to study, you have to read lots of books in order to analyze the data. You have to read lots of books, but this is the overall schematic way in which OSL dating is done. Now, there are other dating techniques as well, which are conducted in glaciers. One is ice core dating. Devabrata, can you just shift to the previous slide? Agitta.
Yes.
Yeah.
This one?
See here. Yeah. Here you can see in the picture that there are green instruments, and these are the OSL dating machines. And there is another schematic diagram showing how the lasers and LEDs are used to heat the sample, and that gives the result. There are other two pictures. On the top, there is a picture where we our teammates were sampling from Moraine. And on the side, there are two pictures. On the side and on the bottom, there are two pictures where we, ice core sampling are shown. And you can also see the sticks that were used as stack of stuff for analyzing the shift in glacial movements. Now, ice core drilling is done like this in the Indian situation. But in Antarctic or the Arctic regions, the ice core drilling is done in a more sophisticated way, and the situations are really worse under minus 50 degrees centigrade. Scientists go there. There are no cooks. There are no one to feed you. There are no one to wash your clothes. Everything you have to do on your own. So if you are interested, GSI does conduct some fellowship and scholarship you know, does give such fellowship and scholarship options in which you can apply, and they take you to Antarctica where there is a military station there, and they will train you before that to stay in such an environment, and otherwise are baap re haath khade karke bhag jao, that kind of a situation can be there. So they will be they'll train you, you have to be physically fit in that, pass the exam, and they'll send you to Maitri. So there you can go and do and see how ice core drilling is done. Acha, then go to the next slide.
Can I play the video?
Just a second. Now here, just above the video, the black patch, you see there are bubbles in the ice, in the ice. Now these bubbles are actually archives of pollens, maybe soot, maybe sulfates. If there has been any volcanic activity, these air bubbles were trapped in the fresh snow and then solidified into glacier ice. The fresh snow was first compacted to fern and then solidified into glacier ice, and frequent superimposition of snow covers have records of temperature conditions, the atmospheric chemical composition within these bubbles. So these from the ice cores, the tube like ice cores that are drilled out, they are taken to the laboratories, they are sliced. These bubbles are analyzed to identify paleoclimatic conditions and how at present we have changed our climate as well, and that can be analyzed. So yes, Devabrata, please play the video.
Sure.
So this is a ice core laboratory in Copenhagen, and you can see these are the ice cores with the names written, and this is the person who has been explaining it. Sorry, you are not able to hear them, but I'll share the link with you. Fast forward it a bit, Devabrata. So they work in minus temperatures, and these ice cores are cut in slices and has to be aligned in a way that you know which part was on the surface and which part was in the bottom. Once if you change the direction, then you see here the ice cores are being, you know, sliced using ceramic slicers, and then these ice cores are thinned down, and you should definitely remember the direction in which the ice core was placed. Once you make it upside down, then your entire analysis will come haywire. So this is done, and then forward the video. What they do is, yeah, see, this is the direction in which they mark it in the laboratory, and they put it in a case, and they melt only the inner portion of the core, and then using very sophisticated techniques, they actually identify the chemical composition. This is the machine in which the ice core is placed, and only the inside of that ice core is tested, because the outside has been handled. They can have some contamination from the outer atmosphere of the present days. So then using these characteristics, the ice cores are dated, and one can analyze the condition. Okay, Devabrata, yeah, this is the dice that you are seeing. So only the inside portion of that square is used for analysis. You can pause the video and we can move forward. I think I've taken a lot of time. I'm so passionate about it, so I'm sharing. I hope the participants are enjoying and I'm not boring them.
No, definitely they are enjoying.
Okay. Now comes another sophisticated method. As I was telling, that we are
progressively moving towards something that is very expensive and needs a lot of funding and infrastructure facilities to get it done. There are laboratories in India in which you can get yourself enrolled and you can do studies. Now, this slide talks about black carbon. Now, what is black carbon? Often you will see in Bengali, we know it as chai or something like soot. Now, anything that is black absorbs light, absorbs heat. Now, black carbon is mostly emitted from industrial emissions, vehicular emissions, and through the atmospheric circulation, they get even transported to not only Himalayan glaciers, but also in the Arctic and Antarctic regions. Now, in order to see the impact of aerosols and black carbon on the glaciers, a specialized instrument known as ethylometer was designed by Tony Hansen in 1980s in Yale University, I suppose. In Yale, he found that using a suction pipe on a filter paper for quite a number of days, he found black dust on that paper. After 20 to 30 years of his research, he found that his hairs have turned white, but that black dust hasn't turned white. So that is how bad a black carbon can be. This black carbon is deadly for health, for respiratory problems, and can be carcinogenous as well, and is definitely bad for glaciers. Now, once you have black carbon layer on your glacial surface, it will absorb more light, it will absorb more heat, resulting in melting of the glacier in the surface below. Thus, the ablation process will be enhanced as a result of black carbon. Now, this ethylometer costs around 18 lakh plus, the one that JNU had purchased. So, and even SASE, that is Snow and Avalanche Study Establishment in Chandigarh, also has such. Professors such as Dhobal has also, you can see on the slide on the right hand side, I've mentioned about the company, it's Maggie. The scientist that I just named, who was the original inventor of ethylometer, Tony Hansen, has opened a company known as Maggie, who supplies this ethylometer. There are other companies as well, but this is one of the most renowned. So he has given this to Professor Dobel and his team, and to SASE and Devicha Center of Climate Change for analyzing the impact of black carbon on, or to understand the concentration of black carbon. Now, what is there within the machine is a very simple technique that has been followed. What is that technique? There is a filter paper inside, or even a running filter paper. Now, there are two different types of models. You will be seeing in the video, I'll be showing it to you later. So there is filter paper and this air suction pump. So the pump keeps on sucking in air from the ambient atmosphere. So what happens, there's a suction pump in the atmosphere, and suction pump in the machine, and it keeps on sucking air. Now, whatever air is being sucked in, whatever aerosol is present gets deposited in the filter paper. Now, there is also a light bulb attached inside the ethylometer. Now, if you keep on depositing certain things and try to see the intensity of light, after a certain amount of deposition, the intensity of light decreases. Now, suppose you take a bulb in your house and you keep it in the kitchen. Most of the times, the kitchen dirt gets stuck on the bulb. You must have noticed. Now, so the bulb's light gets diminished. The same technique has been used in ethylometer. the light intensity keeps decreasing as the carbon, black carbon deposit keeps increasing on the filter paper. So by this mechanism, using the ethylometer, one could understand the amount of the rate at which the light intensity is decreasing is directly proportional to the rate at which the carbon deposit, black carbon deposit is taking place. So we will get a computerized graph in which the carbon deposition, black carbon deposition curve will be shown, and we can see that how the change has taken place. So you can, Debabrata, for a few seconds, just play the video. Previous year. So this is the ethylometer instrument. Now it is, it has a touch screen on it, and this is a calibration unit to help one understand. This is the touch screen by which one can, you know, set the machine and let it start on a running mode, and it will in automatically, when the filter paper gets saturated, the running filter paper gets renewed, and there are temperature analyzers also attached to it, so that we can get to understand that what kind of black carbon content is present in the atmosphere in the glaciers. We can also use it for studying the condition in during Diwali. You can see that after Diwali, what is the aerosol content in or the carbon content in your area. You can study it in the Himalayas, where wood as a medium of fuel is used for cooking purpose or heating, room heating, because that does emit a lot of black carbon. And also one can use it in case of studying biomass burning, because once you burn crops, because in areas of Punjab and Haryana, where there is, you know, multiple time cropping system, they don't even bother to clean the fields. They simply just, you know, set the entire field in on fire once the harvest is over. So in such cases, the black carbon emitted as a result of biomass burning, which now everybody must be knowing that Delhi is so polluted because of the biomass burning that happens in Uttar Pradesh and Punjab and Haryana, this Gangetic belt, because the soot and all this carbon gets, you know, from flown to Delhi by wind direction. So these kind of things can be analyzed and used from using this ethylometer. So yeah, this is over. I'll send you the video. Debabrata, just pause and let's move to the next section. Now coming to use of GPR. Previously also people were asking what the GPR is. So it's a ground penetrating radar. So radar or SAR waves, synthetic aperture or electromagnetic radiation, are actually energy is transmitted from these instruments which penetrate solid surfaces. Like X-ray can penetrate our body, this electromagnetic radiation can also, even our cell phones work on EMR, electromagnetic radiation. There's a certain range of electromagnetic radiation that is used in this GPR instruments, and they are they can penetrate through any solid surfaces. So staying looking over a glacier or through remote sensing, we are not always able to apprehend or understand the depth of a glacier, the thickness of a glacier, how much underwater flow is there in a glacier, or how much debris are, how much ice lies beneath the glacier. It's not feasible for us to understand from remote sensing point of view or through some visual interpretation techniques. So GPR is used in various archaeological studies as well, where we even in urban planning studies, where if you run the GPR machine, which you can see, there are two types of GPR. One is having those two antennas which need to be, you know, carried by so many people, and there is a reading you know, notebook as well, like laptops attached to it, so in which the reading comes. And there's one which is like a drill one. So you can see the second picture where which has wheels attached to it, and you can just push it along the surface. So in urban planning, GPRs are used to see underlying pipelines, leakage in pipelines, underlying, you know, maybe electrical lines, or even underlying buried archaeological sites, some old age cities, ancient cities. So mainly GPRs are used for that. So in case of glaciers, the GPRs are used to study the mass of ice under buried rocks to estimate volumes and even to understand subglacial topography. So often there can be that there has been a drumlin and now it is covered by a glacier. So there are chances, and there are publications also. In the next slide I'll be showing you, but for the time being now just they will go to play the video. How is GPR conduct a GPS survey is conducted on a glacial body. So this is the GPR machine that has actually with it three components. One is the antenna, the other is the control unit, and the third is a survey encoder. Now this antenna has two transmitters, one transmitter which emits the electromagnetic radiation, and the other antenna is a receiver. And what happens, the survey encoder reads the time travel, what is the time taken from the GPR machine to hit the base, to hit the depth till which you want it to reach, and the time taken by the electromagnetic radiation to reflect back to the GPR machine. So how much like it's like an echo. I make a noise, it's fine. Now I make a noise, it hits a wall and it echoes back to me. So depending on that, I'm making a noise, it's hitting back the wall and it's getting back to me. So the electromagnetic radiation hits the bottom, the depth till which you want. There are various frequencies of GPR. High frequencies GPR goes to shallow depths. Low frequency GPR penetrates to a great extent underground in the subsurface. So these GPRs for glacier, definitely will be using a low frequency GPR so that it reaches quite to a lower depth. So what this GPR machine does is they calculate the time travel, how much time it took from me to leave the machine and reach the target, and what time it took for the electromagnetic radiation to hit the target and reach back to the receiver, and also the amplitude, that means the intensity with which the radiation has returned back. On the basis of that, the entire plot gets created. And how does the plot looks like? It looks really messy. It's very, very difficult to understand the GPR readings until and unless you have a thorough training on it, have a very good understanding of what is almost, have some ample training as to what is lying below, what kind of object, how does iron behave, how does a bone behave, how does a brick behave, what kind of parabolic curves, the entire graph looks like a parabolic curve, and what kind of material does a GPR frequency, what kind of dielectric pulse the element is reflecting back. So for air, the dielectric pulse is 1. For water, the dielectric pulse is 81. In between, everything lies. So one has to test the dielectric pulse of each and every element possible, and then understand what can be the result of what. So the result of a particular element lying in the subsurface, whether it's a rock, whether it's water, whether it's a subglacial lake or anything, based on such training. So next slide, Devabrotu. I think I'm taking too much time.
No, ma'am, it's okay.
A few more slides. Missed it.
Just a moment.
Yeah, so these are some papers related to GPR studies. Now you can see the graphs. They look, gibberish to me. When I first studied, I could hardly understand what it interprets. So the paper on your left shows the... anybody saying something?
No, ma'am. Please mute yourself.
So
participants are requested, please mute yourself. Okay, ma'am, now clear.
So the paper on the left shows how a buried drumlin was detected with the help of a GPR, and the paper on your right shows that even like glacial debris that were there, and how much ice is stored under glaciers or under the moraines can also be estimated. So the volumes of ice or the mass of ice can also be studied using a GPR. Okay, next slide. The next slide.
Yes,
now coming to runoff. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible. Please carry on.
So the most abundantly used runoff or hydrological model are wind SRM, Windows Snowmelt Runoff Model, and SWOT. These two models are open source. That's why I have given here that you can also try and use them. There are certain data sets that are required for them. For SRM, wind SRM, you need to have temperature data or snow cover data. Gridded temperature data you can have from LST, MODIS, MOD 11. Snow cover data you can have from MOD 10, or even you can compute through NDSI. And you need to have a digital elevation model with the help of which you can delineate watershed, you can find out the slope and aspect, because they are also necessary. It's also necessary to know which slope faces the maximum sunlight and which doesn't, whether the slope is steep or it's gentle, whether the glacier will slide down slowly or will have an abrupt fall. So for that, a den is required to identify snow cover areas and glaciers. You need Landsat or MOD to have temperature data. You can have from IMD gives gridded data. Aphrodite, you can get it online, download it, and you can estimate spatial temporal changes in rainfall, runoff, and this entire model uses an equation where Q is the runoff amount that on a daily basis the discharge is computed based on a C, which is the runoff coefficient, the degree day, that is the solar radiation that has come in, the surface condition, the snow cover condition, the precipitation. All these data needs to be fit in in SRM, and that can result and give you an output of the runoff. Now, for that, in order to validate your data, you have to maybe purchase a digital current meter or a simple manual current meter and check at the snow at the outlet whether your data, whatever the model is giving to you, is matching your observed data or not, and that will show that your work is correct. Similarly, SWOT also. SWOT is a soil water assessment tool. This is a hydrological model that works with QGIS as well as GRASS and ArcGIS. It's open source software, but it needs huge amount of data if you really want to have an accurate estimation of the runoff from the snow melt. There is a heap SWOT option as well, especially built for Himalayan conditions. It also requires daily precipitation, daily temperature data, solar radiation, land use, soil condition, groundwater level, so humidity, lots of data is required. I have used it. So anyone wants to know how to analyze the or work in SWOT can contact me. My email ID was given in the first slide. But the data required is massive in SWOT. But it's a physical, disintegrated or physically distributed watershed hydrological model, which will give you a very good prediction. So in this way, you can also look into whether increase in temperature is leading to increased runoff or not, whether decrease in temperature is actually leading to decline in runoff, or whatever changes you can definitely model. So these are some of the options you can try out on glaciological studies to see the impact of climate change on the glacier and model the snow melt runoff. Okay, next slide. Now, glacial lakes are also a significant portion. I have come to the end of the presentation. It's also very important for studying. The glacial lakes are also different types of, there are different types of lakes. There are supraglacial lakes, there are moraine dammed glacial lakes, there are lateral moraine dammed glacial lakes, there are subglacial lakes. So these glacial lakes can prove to be a threat, as we saw in case of cloudburst occurring in the case of Kedarnath. And these glacial lakes, in case they are dammed, needs to be analyzed. And by online on-stream digitization techniques, or by carrying out band reissuing techniques like NDWI, you can extract glacial lakes from remotely sensed images and use them for creating inventory of different glacial lakes. Next slide. Now, in order to understand potential threats of glacial lakes, whether the glacial lake can be a probable threat or can lead to a glof, needs to be studied. There are some articles that have already cited here, as well as some articles you can search over the net. So what you need for that, generally some criteria are set that the slope of the glacial lake should be more than 10 degrees. You have to compute NDWI first to extract the lake. You have to have the dam to know the slope at which the lake is placed. You have to also identify whether they are dammed by moraine or not. For that, you would have to use different satellite images. And in those ways, you can identify whether they are potentially threatening or not. Okay, next. So these are a few of the references and these are a few of the references that I have consulted, and most of them I have mentioned in my slides. And if you have any questions, please let me know over the chat, and maybe Devabrata can share it with me. I would like to thank. Is the acknowledgement slide here, Devabrata?
Yes, ma'am.
Sorry, I think it's not there. It's okay. I would like to thank a lot of people for this, especially my entire ICIU Tetrasi team, having Professor Milak Sharma sir and Professor Srikesh, Dr. Sucharita ma'am, Professor at CSRD JNU, my teammates there who are now assistant professors in different parts of the country. I think I would like to share their names with you because I'm so indebted to them for that. So I would like to share, if you don't mind.
Thank you, Dr. Avira Dattaroy, for delivering such an informative speech on cryosphere studies on Indian Himalayas. Ma'am, please stay with us. Now the session
is there. I have just shared the names of my professors who have helped me learn so much and given me an exposure. So yeah, thank you.
Yes, okay. Okay. Now the session is open for question answer interaction. I request Mr. Devabrata Mandal to conduct the session.
Okay, okay. Thank you once again, ma'am, for your captivating and passionate presentation. It is very much informative. You explain these difficult things so clearly. I think everyone enjoy it, and by engaging your valuable informative presentation. Thank you, ma'am, once again. Now we come to the question session. Lots of questions coming from YouTube. I think the first question coming from Paramita Paul. Effect of black carbon in dimension of study in glaciology?
As I had already told, that the effect of black carbon is, if a black carbon layer, it's an aerosol or an air pollutant, it is solid in nature. If it deposits on the glacial body, it will trap more sunlight and more heat, and as a result increase the ablation process or the melting process of the glacier, which is harmful to the environment. So that's why study of black carbon and its impact is necessary.
Another question, ma'am. Nayantara Pal, she asked, is ELA different in every session?
No, ELA is a line. It's an imaginary line, which is equilibrium line of altitude, which tells us or gives us a hint as to whether the glacier is receding or progressing, whether the glacier is in a conducive condition, or whether the climate change has hampered. If ELA is lower or nearer the snout, that means the accumulation has taken more, accumulation has happened and the glacier is progressing. If the ELA line is moving upwards towards the head wall, then definitely the glacier is melting at a faster rate and it is receding, which is harmful.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Another question coming from Ashmita Bhattacharya. She wants to know what is the exactly importance of ELA.
This ELA is the thing to is a line which helps you in studying whether the glacier is receding or progressing.
Next question coming from Pallub Jana. How to get SWOT data?
SWOT data, SWOT, you can go to the website, Soil Water Assessment Tool. They have a dedicated website for this hydrological model, and all the IITs starting from IIT Delhi to Roorkee to Kanpur, all the IITs, especially in North India, have collaborated to form a database where gridded temperature, gridded rainfall, humidity on a daily basis, precipitation, wind speed, all kinds of atmospheric data is available. Also, coarse land use data, soil data you can get from NBSSLUP. All these kind of data are available on their server. SWOT has a dedicated server to it. If you require, I can share the link with the organizers and you can browse through.
Thank you, ma'am. Another question coming from Urpita Chakraborty. She want to know, where can we learn more about this type of glacier related data?
I didn't get the question. Where?
Where did he get the lots of data like glacier and many more about the glacier hazard?
Disaster hazard related data, you can search in NIDM, National Institute of Disaster Management's website, or NDMA, National Disaster Management Authority's website, or else you have to research it out on your own by taking satellite images, either high-resolution Google Earth images or images of multispectral satellite images, and using different threshold values cutoffs. You should study a lot of literature as to how to identify potential blocks or avalanches or areas with glacial lakes.
Another question coming from Ashmita Bhattacharya. She want to know if C14 has fallen more than half or something like that. I think not question completed.
Okay, you have to calculate it backwards. If half life means 5,370 years, then another half will mean obviously some 11,000. Another reduction of another half life will mean that the sample under study will be some 11,000 years old, something like that.
Another question coming from Pollock Jana, how to convert short data in Excel data?
What?
How to convert short data in Excel data? Is it possible?
SWOT data? Okay. SWOT itself takes Excel data into incorporation. It should be in .csv format and it will take. Otherwise, it is in M Access format, which is Microsoft Access. It will take that data into incorporation. And if you need more help, I have a lot of videos on that I can explain. So what is itself a thesis in itself.
Okay, no more question, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thanks a lot. Thank you, Devabroto, for staying up all night to help the participants and me to conduct this program so smoothly. Thank you, Loki sir, for giving me this opportunity. And I'm really thankful to all the participants who have listened. Hope it has been really fruitful.
Most welcome, ma'am. Okay. Our next speaker is Dr. Pratik Das from Adamas University. I request Mr. Devabroto to introduce Dr. Pratik Das.
Am I audible, Lakshmi sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, you are audible.
Welcome, Pratik sir. Now we come to our second session. Pratik sir, he has working as an assistant professor in Adamas University since November 2017. He had obtained PhD degree from Banaras Hindu University in 2016, working in collaboration with IIRS Dehradun on hydrological studies in Shirsha Basin, Himachal Pradesh. Using remote sensing and GIS, he has been awarded as a junior research fellow in 2009, as a research associate in 2017, CSIR. Thank you, sir, and welcome our second session.
Thank you to you, Lakshmi sir and principal sir, as well as most importantly, Abhirab ma'am or Abhiradi. Please let me allow to share my screen.
Yes. Just a
I think most of the participants are very hungry, me as well. So I will rapidly wrap up my presentation. This presentation basically this presentation is basically designed for the graduate and postgraduate students who are interested in remote sensing, but who have some lack in knowledge. So I try my best to increase their interest and knowledge about the remote sensing. But I'll quickly wrap up my session because already it is 2:15 or more. So I'll try to wrap up my session within 20 to 30 minutes within that. Okay. So first I'll cover about remote sensing. Why it is showing? Then about the theoretical concept of GIS. Then basic concept of disaster management. What are the strategy of disaster management? What are the goals of disaster risk reduction? Then application of remote sensing and GIS in disaster management. And finally, some materials on career development on disaster management. So I think all of you know what is remote sensing. Still, remote sensing is the science of obtaining information about the object, area, or phenomena from distance, typically from aircraft or satellite. Okay, so what does it mean? So it is basically a science that helps us to acquire the information from a distant place about any object. Like simply think about our eyes. It see some object and then it is reflected in retina, and then it is connected to our brain through nerve, and then we can analyze or understand the, what are the things. So similarly, in the same analogy, you can replace with a remote sensing system where a sensor that capture radiation, reflected radiation from the surface, mostly if it is passive, then it is the energy source is sun, not always for sun. Sometimes it is used at active remote sensing. Then ultimately it is reflected from the surface or surface materials. Then it is captured by this sensor. And then it returns the signal to the ground receiver station, and that process and send us raw data. So that we have to process. So from that, the geographer start. So that raw data we use to process in different ways. So an image for how the sensor will track this scanning line. And some basic concept about remote sensing. First one is the electromagnetic radiation, which is most important. It is a form of energy propagated as a wave of the field, electromagnetic field. And all the objects radiate electromagnetic radiation. Obviously, sunlight is one of the form of sunlight is also electromagnetic radiation. And most importantly, we see the light, which is the visible spectrum of the total electromagnetic radiation. That we can see a small portion of electromagnetic radiation. And this electromagnetic radiation that is reflected or scattered from the object captured by the sensor. So that is the main our ingredient or the source that by which we can differentiate different object. So next, spectral band. You can see in this image the different spectral signature. The whole spectral range is divided into different regions. From X-ray to ultraviolet, near visible spectrum, near infrared, thermal, and then microwave and radio. So mostly up to this far infrared or the thermal region is mostly used in multispectral image. And then a microwave is mostly used in passive or sometimes in active remote sensing, mostly in active remote sensing and sometimes in passive remote sensing. So in this picture here, you can see the concept of the wave and frequency. So now if we divide this diagram into equal time interval. So now you can imagine the frequency. So this distance between two consecutive peaks is called a wavelength. and number of frequency per unit of time is called frequency. Okay, so here frequency is high. So when wavelength is very shorter, then frequency is very high, and when wavelength is larger, then no, frequency is very less. So frequency less means energy is less, and frequency is very high means energy is high. That's why if you see the spectral band resolution, then most of the thermal resolution or the in that is in high wavelength region like a microwave data, their cell size, that means their spatial resolution is very low, more than 30, 50 or 100, whatever. So that is because energy, less amount of energy is detected from that particular wavelength. And here, this black spot are basically in this region, sensor cannot detect the electromagnetic radiation, and this white spaces shows atmospheric window. That means the reflected energy can penetrate the atmosphere and it is captured by the sensor. So these are most important, these white spaces are, these are the spectrum which are mostly or actually useful in remote sensing. Then some spectral region, I'm not explaining, visible, infrared, then within infrared, it is divided into near infrared, mid infrared, and thermal infrared, and then microwave, and within which microwave, most importantly, when it is imaging scanner, then it is radar is used, radio detection and ranging, and then lastly, it is radio wave. Then surface reflectance, which is most important. Every object reflects electromagnetic radiation, but that depends upon the surface characteristics, physical characteristics, as well as chemical characteristics. And most importantly, temperature. Even in different temperature, the same object can radiate different amount of reflected energy. So when we analyze this satellite data, this spatial information is mostly, we can discriminate based on their spectral characteristics. And different objects, reflect this electromagnetic radiation in a different bandwidth. So here in this picture, actually I'm in a silly hurry. So here, in the visible spectrum near infrared and mid infrared, it is given the picture. So you can see the vegetation, the reflectance of the vegetation is maximum in NIR. That's why when we calculate NDVI, we actually calculate NIR minus red, not red minus NIR. Then digital number, I think most of us is familiar with the digital number. Basically, in raster data contains a value which is called digital number that depends upon the radiometric resolution, which is 2 to the power x. Suppose if it is 8-bit data, then it is divided between 0 to 255. So this DN value actually calculated based on the reflectance, which is captured by the sensor and then processed at ground station. And whatever the data we get for each and every band in multispectral image, each cell contains certain DN value. That DN value infer the reflectance characteristics of every object, as well as their sometimes temperature characteristics. Then resolution, most importantly, spatial resolution. So when we in general talk about the resolution, it is about the spatial resolution. The smallest size can be detected by a sensor. All of you are familiar with 1 megapixel camera, 10 megapixel camera, 15 megapixel camera. So if you, for higher resolution data, smaller the cell size. Then spectral resolution, that defines the number and width of spectral band. For example, LIST-3 has 4 bands and Landsat 8 has 11 bands. So here number of band is very high, as well as the spectral width, if it is very narrow, then that infer very high spectral resolution. That property is used in a hyperspectral data, where suppose the visible spectrum is divided 10th number of spectral bands. Then radiometric resolution. So it is the ability of the sensor that discriminate very slight difference in energy. So if very slight difference in energy that is reflected from the object, if it is detected by the sensor, then we can say radiometric resolution is very high. That is basically defined by the bit of the data, whether it is 4-bit data or 8-bit data or 12-bit data. Suppose Landsat 8 is 12-bit data as well as Sentinel, but TM data is 8-bit data. So radiometric resolution is very high. So radiometric resolution means total DN value range from minimum to maximum number of size. Then temporal resolution, this is basically depends upon the satellite. The same place it is revisited by satellite in two consecutive passes. That is, the time difference is called temporal resolution. Spatial resolution, which is most important to understand. Suppose in this picture, if a 30 meter cell, then if there is some differences within area, we cannot identify, it will be mixed. But if it is 5 meter or 1 meter, we can clearly define the each and every object. So you can see here the difference in between these two images. So when the size of this cell is decreasing, that means it is higher resolution data. Sensor, active sensor and passive sensor. Active sensor means the sensor that has its own source of energy, this one, and passive sensor, that is main source of energy is sun. So the solar radiation which is reflected and scattered from this object, and that is captured by the sensor. So here either energy, especially in Landsat or whatever the different multispectral image that are mostly passive, that capture passive, that are a passive sensor. Then whisk-broom sensor and push-broom sensor. So whisk-broom and push-broom, one is the AcroStrack, which is whisk-broom. It has a scanning system that move like pendulum from one point to another point along the scan line. But in push-broom sensor, it scan instantaneously the whole scan line and move throughout the its path. The various type of satellite and orbit. One is geostationary orbit and near polar orbit based on its the orientation of the satellite. If it is oriented towards east and west, especially the geostationary satellite that are moving almost around the equator, that are geostationary satellite, and near polar orbit, which is a little bit inclined north south in the direction. The geostationary and sun synchronous satellite, these are basically, it has another concept. Geostationary is generally fixed with its position relative to the Earth. That means it has same velocity and same direction as with the same like Earth. So it looks like fixed with respect to the Earth surface for a particular position. But in sun synchronous, it captures same local sun time throughout the every places it moves. So the basic principle is, earlier I told you, if the temperature changes, that means if illumination condition changes, surface reflectance property will change. That's why the basic principle is, so every time it tries to fix the sun, solar time, so it captured every places in same solar time. Then GEO, MEO and LEO, these are basically geosynchronous equatorial orbit that are placed around 35,000 kilometer above. And MEO is the medium orbit. That means from the surface, it is generally 5,000 to 12,000 kilometer it is placed. And LEO is lower Earth orbit, which is around 800 or sometimes it is 700 to 1600 kilometer above the Earth surface. Some satellites and their position. I'm not going into details. So now the digital image processing, which is important to acquire information about the remote sensing data or satellite data. So this is the most important part. So first one is the image rectification and restoration. So image rectification and restoration means to correct the degraded image and to represent a faithful image. Like there may be some certain sort of geometric distortion or radiometric distortion. Then we have to, for geometric correction, we have to geocode and image to image registration. And for radiometric correction, we have to calibrate. Then noise, we have to remove noise and resample. And mostly we are, nowadays we are getting level 2 product, especially when we call about the Landsat. Mostly it is rectified. Sometimes we have to remove the cloud, otherwise it is mostly rectified. Then second is image enhancement. So main objective here is to improve an image appearance by increasing tonal distinction, enhancing or suppressing the pixel value. Actually, image enhancement and image transformation, they work on more or less same principle or objective, but the basic difference is image enhancement is done for a single band, and image transformation we can do for multiple band. That means multi-spectral data, we can at once we can do image transformation, but for image enhancement, we have to do selecting one band by one. So some basic method are contrast enhancement, spatial filtering, whether it may be high pass filter or low pass filter. So if we make it homogeneous, that means if we wish to suppress the smaller details, then we have to use the low pass filter. And if we wish to enhance the smaller details, like if there is road network or very smallest difference in the object, then we have to use a high pass filter or edge detection filter we can use. And in image transformation method, some arithmetic operations are performed. Generally, we use PCA to see the relation multicollinearity, as well as to the relation between to reduce the dimension between different bands. Then image addition, multiplication, change detection we do, and band ratioing, which is NDVI, NDVI, NDWI. These are the image transformation method. And finally, which is most important, image classification. We can do supervised classification system or unsupervised classification system, where supervised classification system is completely based on the user's knowledge, where based on the training sample, we cluster different spectral signature, and we assign them into particular land use class. But in unsupervised classification, the whole image is split into different spectral group based on user specified number of the groups. So some method for supervised classifications are maximum likelihood classification, nearest neighbor and parallelepiped, and for unsupervised is k-means clustering. Some applications of remote sensing, detecting land use and land cover change, which is primarily done by at graduation or master degree level. So first most important task done by the when we are learning
Hello.
I think I got disconnected.
Yes. Disconnected.
Yeah. So PPT is visible now?
Yes.
Okay. So observing climate change, hydrological modeling, flood modeling, then monitoring air quality in the lower atmosphere, like carbon concentration or aerosol. Next is predicting potential landslide zone, where landslide is a landslide susceptibility mapping, drought monitoring or flood monitoring, then crop health analysis, detecting oil spills, marine environment management. Sometimes we also use nighttime luminosity to correlate with economic development, the spread of forest fire, forest disease. So these are some basic application of remote sensing. I'm not going into details here. Yeah? So this is a picture of few applications. We are mostly aware about the recent cyclone, about the Amphan, how remote sensing satellite data help to predict the track of Amphan. So it is mostly most useful in disaster management. I'm coming to that point later. GIS is basically a computer-based information system that uses a procedure or tools to store, integrate, manipulate, query, model, and display geographically referenced data. So most important thing is that the data should be geographically referenced and that has associated some attribute that we can store, process, and analyze, and finally you can visualize to ultimately for decision-making system. So our main goal is we have to take some decision. For that, we need some special data and associated attribute that we can analyze through some tools. We can use model making or batch processing. That means multiple data we can process in the same time. And then we can create some special information as well as some maps from this analysis. So that helps in decision maker or to make a fruitful decision to help real world problem, to solve the real world problem. The concept, some basic concept of in that is used or useful in GIS, that the concept of geographic data, that is especially the data with that has geographical location. So what is geographical location? All of we know it is the latitude and longitude. How do we measure the latitude and longitude? The angular distance from the equatorial plane to up to a certain place along this at the center of the earth, whereas longitude is measured along the equatorial plane up to a certain point over the equatorial plane. So here you can see the most student that confuse or make some mistake during GIS practical class, that in X coordinate they often use latitude, but that is wrong. In X coordinate we have to use longitude, and in Y coordinate we have to use latitude. Projection, I think all of you have studied projection, why we transform this geographic coordinate system to projected coordinate system, that is to transfer three dimension to two dimension system. And then we often use a datum which is reference ellipsoid due to irregularities in the shape of the earth. So most popular method for datum is WGS84, and most popular projection system that is used is UTM. And how we represent data in GIS? Raster data is represented as a pixel or grid. It may be square or rectangular, but generally we use square pixels. But in vector, we represent the data through point, line, and polygon. So in point, and you can see the difference. In raster data, the point is represented as single pixel, but in line, it is a network or array of pixels. But in polygon, it is cluster of pixels. Most important function that we use in GIS, that is overlay, spatial overlay, the spatial data that have some attributes we overlay with each other. One important thing is in raster data, we can insert only one attribute. That means the digital number that contains that reflect only a single attribute. But in vector data, we can put n number of attributes. So some basic overlay option is vector with vector, like union, intersection, erase, clip. Vector with raster, we use clip, but otherwise for vector with vector, we also do that. Then raster with raster overlay, we generally use map algebra, where we use some kind of equation, like NDVI that you can calculate with remote sensing image processing software like ADAS. You can do also same thing on ArcGIS or quantum GIS using map algebra. An example of GIS overlay for wetland mapping. We have different layers of raster and as well as vector data for slopes, stream, buffer, land use, and soils. So these are overlaid to get a certain kind of final output, and that output also help in processing another decision making system for another and further analysis. Work structure in GIS. So first we have to define problem, and then we have to design our work, how we can execute our work based on to solve our problem. We must have to some geographical area over which we are going to function or apply our method or tools. So this is most important. We must have geographical data, that means data with coordinate, whether it may be geographic coordinate system or it may be projected. Then this data must have certain attributes, and then we analyze using some tools and visualize them, and then it helps finally in decision making system. So what are the applications of GIS that mostly coincide with remote sensing? But most importantly, whatever the vector operation we do, that mostly we do GIS operating system. GIS mapping, natural resource management, disaster management and mitigation, flood damage estimation, landslide hazard mapping, environmental impact assessment, hotspot analysis, agricultural mapping and forecasting, even for all insurance you can use, urban planning, transport planning, telecom network, banking, taxation, in different way, or even whether if you wish to set up a particular business, like if you wish to set up a mall, we can do its site suitability analysis. So different function we can do using GIS. Now coming to disaster management. A disaster can be defined as any occurrence that cause damage, ecological disruption, loss of human life, deterioration of human health and health services on a scale sufficient to warrant an extraordinary response from outside that affected community. So any event that has a large impact on our society, that means human, where response claimed by the vulnerable community and response is given from the outside of this community, that we define as a disaster. Then all of you know the natural cause of disaster as well as man-made cause of disaster. Some meteorological, topographic and environmental, these are some basic factors of natural disaster, and then man-made, technological, industrial as well as warfare. But most importantly, whatever the anthropogenic activities that may aggravate the natural disaster. So we cannot explicitly divide these two, but rather somehow they are more or less, they are related with each other. Now, disaster management, the organization and management of resources and responsibilities for dealing with all human aspects of crisis, in particular preparedness, response and recovery in order to lessen the impact of disaster. So ultimate objective of disaster management is to reduce the impact of the disaster through managing the responsibilities as well as resources. Disaster management strategy, if we divide the whole strategy into four groups, first one is the preparation, that is pre-event, then response, which is during the event, and third one is the recovery, which is just after the event, and mitigation, it is long-term planning. So preparedness means some activities which is prior to disaster, like when flood occurs or before the Amphan, the government told us to be secured and move to a safe place. So that is a preparedness, so that we can minimize the life loss. Then response means the response, the rescue team that occurred during the event, that is called response, how quick they execute the emergency activities. And recovery is the activities which is just follow after the disaster, like giving food or shelter, temporary housing. So this recovery is just temporary in terms, but where the mitigation or the planning is a long-term program that includes capacity building, some planning, policy, inclusion. So all the activities that can reduce disaster or the effect of the disaster, because we cannot nullify the disaster or the impact of the disaster, but we can reduce that. So that long-term planning or the progress is called the mitigation. Now disaster risk reduction. So there is an earlier disaster risk reduction, or the disaster management is mostly believe in relief-centric, but later it is moved to structural and then non-structural measures. So structural measures is like construction of cemented wall river beside the river. So this is an example of structural measure, and but non-structural measures like implementation of policy, some regulations, awareness, these are the non-structural measures. So nowadays it is more implemented. So it is a systematic approach to identify the risk and then ultimately reduce the risk. So UNISDR, it is initiated in the this initiative program in 1999, and in 2005 NDMA was launched by government of India, and then in the same year Hugo framework for action was prepared for the disaster risk reduction, where five preliminary target was given, and most of the nations tried to follow that. Our country follows in a good way. They have prepared a national disaster policy. Then Sendai framework, now we are following that in 2015 to 2013. That is some guideline where in from the Hugo framework to Sendai framework, where the main responsibility is given to the state as well as to the stakeholders. So ultimate goal of disaster risk reduction or DRR is to reduce the disaster risk and prevent new risk. So for that, we have to reduce the hazard exposure and vulnerability of the disaster, then increase the preparedness, and finally, we have to make a resilient community. So if the vulnerability is high, so vulnerability is the susceptibility of a community. So what are the conditions, whether the community is prone to flood or drought or landslide. So this, if the community is more susceptible, then it is vulnerable, which is basically that cause more disaster, more that magnify the disaster. Whereas resilience community means they are the people who are exposed to disaster, but they have certain ability that can absorb or reduce as well as recover quickly from that disaster. For an example, earthquake in Japan as well as earthquake in Nepal. So Japan quickly recover from its position. So they're more resilient community rather than the third world countries like Nepal. So some key concept on capacity building. So focus on holistic disaster risk reduction. Then strengthen the functional capacity, work across the organization. Then that means basically, which is important, multi-institutional collaboration between the different government agencies as well as different NGOs and private organizations. Then careful planning and designing program for lasting impact. So we should be very economic, and that program should have a great impact and that lasts for a long period of time. We have to make a certain plan design. And then most importantly, we have to pay attention to the local context. So for example, if we formalize any law, then it may not be effective for the local people. The law may be generalized for a particular country or the state. So we have to think about the local context and the perception of the community. Then disaster management, how remote sensing and GIS can help in disaster management. So developing disaster warning system, potential hazard zone mapping, monitoring, like monitoring the events during the cyclone or forest fire. So we can monitor like IMD did it during the Amphan or previously in different cyclones. Then damage assessment for the relief and insurance grant. So whatever the relief is given by the government and that can be done biasly without any scientific assessment, or that can be done correctly through scientific assessment, like using the remote sensing and GIS. You can we can estimate what are the actual damages and who are the affected people, and then we can monitor the rehabilitation and then evacuation of the site for reconstruction. We can find a new suitable place where new construction can be done, and it provides a database for recurrent event and post disaster census that help in decision making and planning. So mapping of hazard area and magnitude of the disaster, tool for planning an evacuation route. So during the response, or that means during the event, it helps us to the way how we can evacuate the people or the vulnerable community or the affected community, and design of centers for emergency operations. Then relief operation extremely useful, especially with the help of GPS. We can the rescue team can operate easily. Now, how remote sensing can help? Remote sensing and GIS can help in different strategy of disaster management. In preparedness, we can identify the emergency area and how we can make assign or locate some important institution that can help during this event, and location of the shelters, route mapping for strategic plan response. So during the event, we can provide accurate information for the exact location where actual disaster happened, and make a route plan for to evacuate the people from that place. And in mitigation, the representation of high risk area facilitates the implementation of necessary mechanism to minimize the impact. So it helps in mitigation. So how we can minimize the impact, especially during rehabilitation. And then planning for long-term planning and decision-making. It is most important to use remote sensing and GIS. I will show in a case study that I done in my previous one study in Uttarakhand. So some application in flood, example, in flood, how we can apply remote sensing and GIS. We can do inundation mapping. We can prepare a flood depth map, damage assessment, potential hazard zone mapping, and flood warning system. Similarly, for drought, we can predict the drought, we can assess the damage, we can develop, help to develop irrigation network and water harvesting. And during cyclone, we can give early prediction system, we can damage assessment, we can monitor for the progress of this cyclone. We can do hazard mapping and drainage system development to remove the excess water. And a case study that work is done by me and my supervisor when I was in JNU with my guide, Professor Mila Punia. We studied on Uttarakhand. Actually, the framework is given on the right-hand side. Basically, we did, we analyzed the different policy that is given by government agencies, different institutions, as well as by the court, and what is the actual real in the real scenario, how it is, whether it is followed or not. We did risk assessment using hydrodynamic modeling. Here you can see the inundated area of the flood in Uttarakhand 2013, around the Bhagirathi River basin is done, and we assessed here from the center line of the river on both of the site, 172 meter is the flood prone or inundated area, and the government, Supreme Court, that gave an order that construction is banned for 180 meter along the side of the river Bhagirathi to reduce for further damage in future. So we can combine here our remote sensing and GIS based application with the policy and decision making system. If the policymaker adopt this scientific method, they can develop policy in such a way that can reduce the disaster risk. Then flood preparedness, it can be used. Then ultimately, that combinedly, it help for long-term flood management system and policy. Another work I did with one of my junior that is published in just a few months ago. This is International Journal of Strategic Management. Here we did a multi-criteria decision-making system. 8 criteria taken and expert opinion has been taken for each criteria. And then using AHP, we halted these maps and found and find the area special map of the area which is more prone to flood hazard. And then we validated with that actual scenario with the for a flood that happened in August 2016, 20th August 2016. And we prepared using NDVI an equation of NDVI as well as so in that is it is difficult, especially in agriculture area to map actual flooded area because agricultural field is mostly filled with water. But am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Okay. So in that case, I have prepared NDVI as well as NDWI and gave a condition that for a area it can identify as a water or flooded area if NDWI value is greater than the threshold and NDVI value should be less than the threshold. So in that case, we can identify that area as a flooded. And we matched with that our prepared flood hazard index, and we have calculated the risk for different land use category, and we found a similarities between these two methods. So in this way, these are two examples how we can use remote sensing and GIS in disaster risk reduction or in decision making system. Most importantly, finally, upon conclusion, so it is we should be very careful about the data we are selecting for disaster risk reduction, and then whatever the criteria we are selecting, its resolution and the methodology, we should be more expertise on that field. Otherwise, it will be very difficult to scientifically apply the knowledge of remote sensing and GIS in disaster risk reduction. Now I have given based on my knowledge and experience, how student can acquire their knowledge in different education level. So at graduation level, they should have some basic knowledge and GIS digitization, some basic vector operation. They can, it would be very good if they have knowledge on QGIS or in other GIS platform and Google Earth. In postgraduate level, they should have some theoretical knowledge on remote sensing, then vector and GIS operations, image processing, and it would be better if they have some statistical knowledge, detailed theoretical knowledge, at least primary statistical knowledge, and some software like Excel or R, whatever, and some modeling related to remote sensing and GIS. And then in advanced level, later they can acquire some statistical package like SPSS or R, programming language like R and Python. Then they can use more data modeling and big data handling like Google Earth engine. It will help their career to get a good amount of salary and to fix them a good position. And then later, around after 10 years experience, they can learn machine learning, which is nowadays most important and a big paid job for machine learning for the special data as well as for non-special data. And they can be expert on programming language. It is very easy, like if they have knowledge on WebGIS. Basically nowadays, most of the company who paid high amount of salary, they need a lot of knowledge from the expert, lot of knowledge from the candidate. And some institute that where disaster management is taught, and some job opportunities. for disaster management, job opportunities offered by various government agencies and some private agencies like RMSI, which is in Noida. There are many number of institute, and they can work in different work as consultant or in different field like teaching, research, preparing documentation, report writing, or training organizer or field trainer. They can also work on work with NGOs like World Bank, Asian Development Bank, UNO, Red Cross, different organizations. There are a lot of opportunity for disaster risk, disaster management, who are learning disaster management, because we are getting more prone to disaster. So we have to minimize disaster, not only on the remote sensing field, it may be policy field, policy related field, or it may be some kind of technique that help in capacity building. There are many kind of opportunities. Student, if they can choose this field for their future, I think they'll get a bright future. And thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pratik Das, for delivering such an informative speech on application of remote sensing and GIS on disaster management. Sir, please stay with us. Now the session is open for question answer interaction.
Okay. Let me remove this here.
Okay, lots of questions coming from participants from both Zoom and YouTube Live. I have taken only 4 topic related questions. One important question coming from Haradhan Kormokar, NCC and NSS volunteer, Jamini Rai College. He asking, is there any relationship among the spatial, spectral and radiometric resolution? If yes, tell me in detail.
Okay.
May I repeat, sir?
Yes, I got. Actually, spectral resolution does not relate with the spatial resolution, first of all. Actually, it has for a larger, if it has wavelength is very higher, like in radar or microwave region, or if it is thermal infrared TIRS, which is called, in that case, we get low spatial resolution. But if the frequency is very less, so in that case, we get finer resolution. But a satellite that contains or a sensor have how many numbers of say, band, that depends upon the who are sending the satellite. Not that is related with the number of bands. Now coming to radiometric resolution, radiometric resolution is also not actually related with the spectral resolution. If the resolution is, sorry, spectral resolution is in for lower frequency, low wavelength. So in that case, radiometric resolution will be generally high, but for the very high wavelength, radiometric resolution is generally low. And coming to the temporal resolution, there is a close relation between spatial resolution, temporal resolution as well as spatial resolution, because when spatial resolution is very high, that means pixel size is slow, its swath is narrowed down. So it requires more time to revisit the same place again. But for Sentinel data, nowadays, if you can see, it has very high spatial resolution, which is 10 meter, but its temporal resolution is 5 meter, because Sentinel actually used 2 satellites, same kind of satellite, Sentinel 2A and 2B, that has actual 10 days revisiting period, but as it has 2 same kind of satellite, then it actually we are getting at 5 days interval. Next question.
Thank you, sir. Another question coming from Sutisna Kundu from TDB College. How can we predict earthquakes using remote sensing and GIS?
Predict?
How can we predict earthquakes using remote sensing and GIS?
Okay, sorry, it cannot be done. Not only using GIS, there are lots of researches going on using some different other instruments. It cannot be predicted.
Okay. Another important question coming from Bonna Chakraborty from Dr. Bhupendranath Dutta Sriti Mahavidyalaya. How can we apply remote sensing and GIS knowledge to manage landslide?
Okay, landslide though I am not expertise in landslide, but whatever knowledge I have. So in landslide, we can use landslide susceptibility mapping, where first of all, we can prepare what are the event, past event. We can map what are the possible zone where landslide is happening. That means historical data, we can map that. Then we can prepare susceptibility mapping, that means risk mapping. We can select some factor like geology, soil, its hydraulic conductivity of the soil, and slope, many kind of data we can use. And based on that, we can, but by overhauling, we can prepare a risk data. And we can as well prepare some route map. If the community who are staying in that zone, how we can help them if there is some kind of landslide. So this kind of planning can be done.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Potik Das.
Thank you for giving me such opportunity. I think all of you are hungry, very hungry.
Okay. I request Mr. Debabroto to conduct the concluding song of our webinar.
Hello. First of all, once again, thank you, respected Potik sir, such an effective session. We are very lucky to have you here. Thank you once again, Avira ma'am and Potik sir. And thank you.
I had a plan to extend the session, but most of the time.
Anyway. But our program now is streaming in YouTube as well as Zoom. More than 500 participants, they are joining through YouTube as well as Zoom. And not only they are participate from West Bengal, they are across the country as well, different country like Malaysia, Indonesia, Nigeria, and many more. Total participants registered in 1200. So it is very pleasant for us. And thank you our principal for conducting this webinar and helping us. Thank you once again, Potik sir and Abhiram. Now I request Rupkatha for a concrete song. Rupkatha.
Hello.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
One more thing before the song. This song is very much related to the geographical perspective. I hope we'll listen carefully to this song. It is very much related to our topic as well as our environment.
I'm not sure what I'm doing.
Thank you so much, Rupkatha. Thank you so much. Now I request all the participants, please put on your video, please, for a snapshot. Please put on your video. Please, all the participants request, please put on your video.
আমি আরেকটা কথা বলতে চাই, আমি গানটা শুরু হওয়ার আগে ওটা বলতে ভুলে গেছি।
ও ডিফিনিটলি শিওর বলো।
হ্যাঁ, তো গানটির কথা লিখেছেন, বাংলায় অনুবাদ করেছেন শ্রী শেখরনাথ মুখোপাধ্যায়, এটা আমি বলতে ভুলে গেছিলাম। আর হিন্দি ভার্সনটা হচ্ছে গাঁও ছোড়াব নেহি, ওই ভার্সনটা থেকে বাংলায় অনুবাদ করা হয়েছে।
নাও আই রিকোয়েস্ট মঞ্জরি লিম্বু, প্লিজ পুট অন ইওর অডিও। হ্যালো, I think she is from other countries. Manjari Limbo, please unmute yourself.
Hello, hello sir.
How do you feel today?
So I'm feeling good. Hello?
Yes, yes, you are audible.
Yes, sir.
You are from?
Hello.
Can you introduce yourself, Manjari?
Yes. Good evening, everyone. Okay, my name is Manjari Limbo, and I'm from Sikkim. I'm a PhD. Hello.
Yes, yes, you are audible. Please carry on. If anyone from our participate, if you share to your experience, you can, please.
Hello.
Yes.
I'm Arpita Chakravarti from Jadavpur University. I'm a second year post-graduation student. I would like to say that this session was very informative, and I would like to thank Dr. Abhira ma'am for sharing such experiences with us, and Dr. Pratik sir also. And I hope this will be very much important for our future. And thank you so much.
Welcome, Arpita. Anyone more? Okay, over to Yadav sir, please conclude the session.
Okay, at the conclusion of our one day national webinar on application of remote sensing and GIS on disaster management, I would like to thanks to Dr. Avira Dutta Rai for delivering the informative and interactive lecture on cryosphere studies in India and Himalayas. Next, I would like to thank Dr. Pratik Das for delivering the informative and interactive lecture on application of remote sensing and GIS on disaster management. Next, I would like to thanks to Honorable Principal Sir Dr. Pradeep Kumar Banerjee for helping me in every way. I would like to thanks to my brother Mr. Devabrata Mondal for his hard working to help me in every way. And next, I like to thanks to the organizing member Professor Saswata Mukhopadhyay, Professor Mitar Pal, Professor Nabarun Sit, Professor Abhishek Bandopadhyay, Professor Mohua Mukherjee. Last of all, I would like to thanks for all participants who made the seminar a great success. Thank you.
And one more thing, just added, we will send the feedback link through your registered email address, okay? So don't worry about the feedback link, okay? Thank you all.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pratik sir.
I have commented on some question personally on this chat box to some participants.
Okay, sir.
I commented them.
Okay.
So if you have any further question, please you can ask me. My contact email ID is kuchit.das@adamasuniversity.ac.in. You can ask a question. You can put your question on. I'll help
thank you.
You.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Bye.
Thank you all. Bye.